It's Wednesday. Riley and Macuga beating the piss at each other. And I had to wait 15 minutes for swimming lane this morning, but I did it.
You did?
Yeah, I had to wait.
Do not like swimming with other people.
I went up doing it for a little bit. I didn't want to do that first. And both the people who were like, hey, you can share my lane. And I was like, hey, you know, I'll wait. Yeah. And then one of the other people were waiting, jumped in the lane, shared. Nice. And I'm like, I'm going to be here forever. So
the slow ones?
No. Okay. No, it's just they were just doing, you know, these were like people who actually swim. Okay. And I'm in the back, you know, flapping my arms. Like,
you just crushed that camera.
Sorry, Cody.
You've done it to me like.
Cody, how's that?
No, it's so bad.
It looks so bad.
Does it?
No, I'm not even in it. No.
All right, we're going to have to start the show over real quick. Okay, just fade out. Alex, get out of here!
It's the best I can do.
You're
sorry,
messing
Cody.
Up my shot.
Well, that should go. That should let you know that's
so
what I'm doing.
Crooked. Yes,
that's what I'm doing in the pool.
I'm crooked.
Well, all you're going to do is give us side glances in that camera.
Crooked.
Anyway.
Can I tell you something?
That's all I do.
Into that camera.
I also can't find places.
Thank you.
Oh, that's true.
You know, and you knew I was going there, right?
I knew.
So
I knew it was coming.
We're gonna get deep into the Men in Black. Three movie and, okay. or four movie and just a
you
little bit.
You can spoil the hell out of it.
Yeah, well, we're not going to spoil it. We're not going to spoil it, but we are going to review it a little later. Yeah. But I witnessed something that last night that was
sad.
Just incredible.
Sad.
So Roxy and I met beforehand, just kind of
at the food court. Oh,
and she was eating. I was supposed to have dinner with her, but I didn't.
Ate by myself.
You didn't eat by yourself. You sat with me.
Well, I ate.
You
by
ate
myself,
by yourself, but you didn't sit by yourself. I had to eat with the family.
That was misleading.
Yeah, it was. But anyway,
I was misleading.
Yeah. You said
saying,
sat.
Do you want to get dinner together and then not eating? Is that misleading?
Well, you sat with
But me. I told you when I walked in, though, I said I had to eat with the family.
Yeah. And so, you did offer. You said, I'll get something small if you need me to.
Yeah. So you don't have to eat by yourself.
That would have been the perfect time for a Joe's slice. But unfortunately,
there's no more Joe's anymore.
I'm so crooked. You can't fix it at all.
I'm editing it from back here.
Thank you, Cody.
I'm so sorry, Cody. So we go to the screening, we watch the movie, which again we'll talk about in a little bit. So I know how to navigate. It's huge now, that place, Century City.
Oh, it's crazy.
There's, in the food court, an oyster shucking place. There's a Brazilian barbecue.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But that's just one area.
That's just one wing.
I can't find shit.
But I know now how to navigate. To where you pull in, you go right up the stairs and you just loop around. Mm-hmm. So I know exactly where I'm going now. Every time when I go to that mall, it's easy.
Humble
so
brag.
So I say to Roxy as we're walking out, I'm like, I'll walk you to your car because it was like 9:30, 10 o'clock at night. And I don't like when people in general are walking down those places. So I say to she's like, I think I'm on this side. So we start walking.
Uh-oh.
And I'm like, I think we're going to be pretty close to each other. She's like, no, I'm at Bloomingdale's. I go, and I'm thinking in my head, I go, I don't like Bloomingdale's. It's still going
to
be open.
This is how I have to do things. Mm-hmm. So the only way to get from A to C is to go A, B, C. I can't go Q, F, R, C. I'll never get there. So I've learned this about myself. I have to retrace my exact steps to find my car.
This was a comedy show because mm-hmm. when I started walking. First of all, she didn't know. All I said was we can just go all the way downstairs this way, and she actually made me loop around a little bit more than I had to go. So she goes to Bloomingdale's and she goes to open. There's no one even close to A inside the store.
I didn't think they would lock the store.
And she's like holding the
doors.
I don't
know why I didn't think that, but I didn't.
She's holding the doors, pulling on the doors with this defeated laugh. Of knowing that it's just not going to happen.
Well, because I know I'm in trouble.
You're in trouble.
Like, trouble.
Not being able to find your car.
I'd already written down. I knew
when you hit your thingy, does it beep? Does it?
The car, yeah.
I'm embarrassed. So I don't know. But I do know that every time I park somewhere, I write down. I wrote P2 and 6. P2 and 6.
And I said, I'm pretty sure you're going to be pretty close near me. She's like, I don't think so. I'm on the other side over here. So then we go all the way down.
Because I was at Bloomingdale's and you were not. Bloomingdale's was the way that I got up.
But from the way that it's situated, we're going to be near each other. But anyway, so we start going all the way.
I didn't think so.
You didn't think so. Okay. Because then we start going. We go down to the bottom, and then she starts going to the right again. I go, no, it's this way. She's like, no, ends over here. And so I don't think so. And she walks.
Because
so she walks to the wrong side
the
again.
The sign told me that.
The sign did not.
The
say
sign
that.
In my soul.
In your soul said that. Okay, that's fine.
Don't listen to that part.
GPS in your head.
Just to tell you, we were six spaces away from each other. Six spaces
Why
away.
Why didn't you take your...
She did once we got down there.
I had to.
That's how she found it.
Okay.
But six spaces away. And
six spaces?
All she had to do was...
But my car was... I went a different route.
Your car is bright effing red.
It's true, but I went a different way.
Every car in the Century City parking lot is either white or black.
Yeah,
you have a bright
red car.
There
are a lot of gray cars.
Yeah, gray,
too. But it was something...
That's a combination of white and black, just so you know the color wheel.
Yeah, but you said they were white or black.
Or gray.
There's a lot of gray area
It was something to see firsthand. It really was.
Why did Reilly just get so angry with that story?
No. I don't think he's angry.
I don't think he's angry.
Did nobody catch this? He just said...
It has nothing to do with you.
Uh-oh, what happened?
It has nothing to do with
anything. Feels like a big deal.
Did something happen?
Yeah.
What?
I forgot to put something up against the door when I left this morning.
What was it?
Oh, for
Leia. For the puppy.
Oh, and it's caused some shit?
It's because she's going to eat the door.
Oh, you forgot.
Yeah, I forgot to block that
so
little area.
So no one reminded you. It just came to you.
It just came to me, and I went.
Now you know how I feel when I can't find my car.
Yeah.
Fuck.
Yeah. You know,
I mean, we don't have any guests coming in today, so you can. Oh shoot,
we do.
We do.
We do have guests.
Director
coming in
of
today.
Toy Story 4 coming in.
And producers.
And producers. Yeah.
I couldn't find their Twitters. I could only find the directors. I couldn't find. I had to do a
producers
hashtag
do
situation.
Twitter.
Yeah, they do.
It doesn't matter. Look, the good thing is you're not going to need to tweet them. You can talk to them when they're here.
No, I wanted to tweet to promote.
That's fine.
And I did.
Good for you.
After I found my car, with my own help. It's like
with your own help. Unbelievable.
There's this thing that happens where
you'd be walking around in Encino right now.
She's acting like she's Sacagawea, but more than likely she's the lost person in the back of Lewis and Clark's van. She's like la 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 la. I'll drink the wine.
Yeah.
It's like self sabotage though, because my brain promises me it's like it is right. Like your car is to the right, and then I go right, and it is not.
I know,
but
that was what was so baffling last night is the fact that you know how bad you are at these things, and I'm telling you, no, it's this way, and you're like, no, and
no.
It's like I couldn't even try to convince her. She just floated off
because
to the right, and I'm like,
like,
and I'm watching her go, and I'm thinking, I start counting down, 4, 3, 2, 1. It's not over there. Yeah, I know. And we walk over.
You walk into a sushi restaurant. She's like, I'll have the General Tso's. We don't have it. I will have the General Tso's. They don't serve that here. Well, I'm still going to eat the General Tso's. Well, great. You can just eat
it. I don't know what it is. Yeah. Like, I'm so my brain stops working, and it's positive I can do it.
You
and
know,
it just, like,
I can
knows.
I can attest to that. That's what I saw last night, for sure.
I wonder what, if you had not been there,
you would be walking around the AMC lobby right now. Yeah,
it's
or
bad.
Yeah,
but
at least Bloomingdale's
down.
Would have been open now.
That's true.
I always write it down though, because
showered
there's those
in
people
the employees
that,
closet. Or
the people that go around the parking lot in the little golf carts, right? Sometimes to help you.
The standing Segway.
Yeah. So I always write it down because they know P2 and 6. Mm-hmm. So I say that, and then they.
But my point was that you. My point is that you went through way too many steps.
No, but
she needs to go A to B to C. If she doesn't have the B in the middle,
well, she couldn't even find F G H L A B C.
I did find B. I found Bloomingdale's by myself.
I was with you.
I knew it was there.
I took
though.
You on the course.
I also knew Bloomingdale's existed.
Okay. Anyway. Yeah. Slow clap.
Well done.
Slow clap.
It's really fucking hot in here. Holy shit.
I don't know if I mentioned this to you yesterday.
A black shirt.
No, I know. I told.
So they don't see my pits.
Oh.
I was telling somebody, but I didn't bring it up, and I don't know if we're having the conversation, but I was going to bring it on air, and I forgot, and Cody will definitely like to get into this as well. No, you did not. You were not part of this conversation, but you're going to love it. I went down a rabbit hole the other night when I was doing work, whatever, too, but something popped up. Maybe I was looking at the David Ortiz stuff. I was trying to find out more about him, and I got into a rabbit hole of the greatest baseball brawls of all time.
Oh, yes.
And it was like a 18-minute video.
Ken and I have to... That's an awesome video.
It was
right
an 18-minute video.
That's when you look at the time code, you're like, let's go.
It was so funny because I was saying this last... I said this last night that I was...
Ryan, Robin Ventura.
Of course. Yeah. I was being the shitty Yankee fan for a second because I'm like, oh, here's another Red Sox fighting somebody else. And right afterwards, there was a Yankee one.
Yeah, totally.
The Yankees and Red Sox were, and not against each other, not just. There was like four or five against each other, but then there were.
Do they do the Don Zimmer one?
What were some of the other big ones?
There was the Ray Knight, Eric Davis.
Yes, that was a great one.
And Ray Knight, again, I was a Mets fan, but Ray Knight was a dick.
Yeah.
I mean, because Eric Davis like slid into third, and they were like arguing with each other, and Ray Knight didn't even hear another word. He just popped him with the right hand, socked him right in the eye. And, like,
he wasn't having it.
No, man. And then there was another one, Ray Knight, right right beforehand. It wasn't necessarily a fight, but it was a scuffle with the famous pine tar with George Brett at the Yankees. Do you know this whole thing that happened? So this is 1983, I believe, and
greatest moments in sports history.
This is crazy.
Then maybe I do know it.
So Yankees were winning 4-3 in the ninth inning, and George Brett is up and he hits a home run and ties the game. Right. So
it wasn't even the playoffs; it was regular season.
Just regular season. Billy Martin comes, and it would have helped for stats and stuff that he was, because he's one of the greatest players of all time.
Yeah.
Billy Martin comes out and starts talking to the umps, and they realize he's got a lot of pine tar on his bat. So they start measuring the pine tar and they put it against the plate, and the announcer's like, "That's crazy. I've never seen that before." And then the guy goes out. Yankees win the game. Yeah. They take away the home run, and George Brett storms in like he's ready to like rip the umpire's head off his body. It's
I
crazy.
Imagine it's that woman who got in the cage against the snow leopard, what that tiger looked like running at that woman.
It's crazy.
I wish we could play him.
I think you can play that George, because it's on. Mm-hmm. You can play the George Brett. Just put George Brett pine tar. You can see the run.
Real quick.
Yeah, you can see. You'll be able to see that. Because that's not major. It's not Major League Baseball.
It's just like ricksvideos.com.
Yeah. You just see the it's so quick. You can just see the actual them running through, and you don't even necessarily have to play the audio of it. You can just show him run out, and we can tell you exactly what the hell's going on. But I just type in for those who want to see this George Brett and the pine torrents in here. So he smashes the home run, and it's a shot. And it would have tied up the game, or he actually would have put him in the lead. I think it would have put him in the lead. Because it was 4-3. It was 4-3, and there was a man on base.
Oh, okay.
It would have been 5-4.
Yeah.
So they take the bat, they throw it off the side, and just fast forward a little bit more.
Here comes George Brett.
Yes, this is for me. So now they're still looking. Billy Martin. I was looking. Look how much pine. How do they notice that? Like, how does he notice that?
I don't know. I don't know.
You know what I mean? So now they're doing all the measuring.
Which honestly, having the pine tar that high in the bat doesn't really matter. It doesn't help the hitter. It doesn't do anything.
No, it doesn't. It's not like corking your bat.
No,
it's not like corking your bat. So, but either way, so now they're looking at it and just go a little bit fat. Like,
yeah.
Cody, have you ever seen this clip?
Oh, yeah, that's a classic.
Of course.
Now they're telling George Brett, who, by the way, George Brett looks like the dude in high school who punched every nerd in the face.
He's just a farmer, dude.
Oh, like, yeah. Huge.
Do you guys think they made the wrong call?
Huge.
I'm a Yankee fan.
Well, it's a rule. It's a rule.
It is a rule. But I mean, it's like but they're reaching here and look, if you can get this is a Jeff Snyder move.
Oh, yeah.
And if you can make the judges sway your way.
Total Jeff
then
Snyder
go for
move.
It. Yeah, absolutely. So we'll just fast forward
a
little bit.
Roxy comes out and like she's got that question wasn't fair.
Because Brett's like, there's no way they're gonna overturn it. Yeah. Once they give the out sign, watch what he does. Like,
it's great. Here comes
Brett. Watch. Oh, so he walks over and to the dugout.
Old school umps.
Yeah, and so there's no way George Brett thinks anything's gonna happen.
No way.
So they're walking. They got this bat.
And if you're not a Yankee fan, which I'm not, you don't like the Yankees.
It's like the evil empire. So they're measuring the pine tar here. This is what they're doing. Look how much pine. There is a lot of pine tar on the bat.
Ton of pine tar on the bat.
Go back. Right there.
Yeah.
Right there. So now he goes over. Ow. Now look at George.
Here comes George Brett.
Look at him. Look. Look. I mean, do you want that maniac coming at? Look at him.
Yes.
Yeah. What I love is
they got him in a chokehold.
He didn't even get a punch off.
No. He wasn't going. I don't think he was swinging fists, but it was. That's an absolute maniac coming after you.
Oh, man.
I mean, he was so calm, cool, and collected in that dugout until that happened.
And they hadn't started testing for roids yet, and everybody was on him. So you know there was a little bit of
Not
rage.
Back in 82.
Lyle Alzado was 81.
Really?
Yeah. But when he started.
But it didn't hit baseball until like 86.
Yeah, you might be right.
Yeah, that's when Canseco.
I'm not like trying to accuse George Brett. I hope like George Brett fandom. Like,
no, I don't think so. Man, I don't think baseball started getting hit with that stuff until like the late 80s because that's when Canseco and
have
McGuire
you seen
were the
bigger, stronger, faster. Have you seen that documentary?
Yeah.
Because they, I mean, Schwarzenegger used it in the 70s to get to Mr. Olympia.
All the wrestlers. Yeah, I just don't think that it hit the. It certainly did hit baseball. I just don't think it hit it in the amount that it hit it until like the late 80s, and then obviously the early and mid 90s, or even late 90s is when it really blew up.
I mean, I'm on the side of like. If it helps you recover and you want to do it, just take steroids. Just let them take the steroids. I'm not saying
that's unfair though to the rest of the players that don't want to do it.
But if they can do it and it gives them an advantage and it's regulated and it's healthy, because dude, if you watch Bigger, Stronger, Faster, all of the myths about steroids that you've been told by like Reefer Madness is false.
But look at Barry Bonds. Barry Bonds was like 86 pounds soaking wet with boots on. And then
but
he
if
took
they're
that
hitting 73 home runs, tell me how fun is baseball?
That's a different argument.
Yeah.
It's a different argument.
If they're doing it healthy and every player is doing it, like, but let's see pitchers throwing at 110.
Is it possible to do it healthy?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. 100%.
Now it is. But yes. But the thing is now, not everybody wants to do that. A lot of people want to do it naturally.
Yeah.
And you should, like, they shouldn't be, you shouldn't tell them, hey, listen, you know, Lou and Sam, they're getting jacked up, so you need to get jacked up too. Because that's just the way it is.
I mean,
it's not really.
I agree. I mean, there are arguments, but
you just
want to
see home runs every day.
I want to see home runs, but I also want to see players' careers last as long as humanly possible. And steroids help you recover. They help you recover from injury. It's depending on the certain ones you take, like HGH. If you take it, it helps you recover. It actually helps the human body.
I feel so hot. I feel like I'm gonna pass out. Do you guys not feel that way?
I'm very hot.
Like I'm literally
sweat
having
dripping
a hard
from my
time
lip
breathing.
Into my
well,
mouth.
we can't have the director and producer in here with us.
I'm
telling you, Ralph Macchio
sitting.
Was in here, and he was in. He had that coat on. He was in bad shape, man.
I looked at how old Ralph Macchio is.
I was 60.
It is bonkers.
I know.
He looks like he's 45.
I know.
Maybe.
I know.
Yeah.
And he's running, and
he
he's still
younger,
and he's still doing jump kicks.
Yes. Still doing the crane kicks with the soldiers.
I know.
Only for the
he was cool, man.
Yeah.
That airs tomorrow, by the way, for everybody who wants to see it. And he tells a great story about Elizabeth Shue.
Yeah.
That is.
Oh yeah.
When he told me,
it hasn't aired.
Tomorrow. So when he.
I almost gave spoilers.
No, don't do that because there's something because it was funny because I asked him a question, and I couldn't believe the answer that he gave.
I know.
Yeah, me too.
I couldn't believe it.
Last time I saw it was 86.
We're gonna
give you a little tease.
Yeah. Yeah. So I want people to
but they don't know in what way.
And why.
And how.
And why. So
and
it's
who.
Like yes. It is
they
it,
do know
it
who.
Is a must listen to tomorrow. Ralph Macchio on Clatter Live. Had him for like 25 minutes and it was really
great.
He would have stuck in here for an hour if it wasn't 30,000 degrees.
Well,
sure.
It wasn't just that, it was that they were I mean
I
they were pulling
pushing.
Him out. He doesn't live here.
No.
He lives in the East Coast, so he just comes in, he does his thing and he
I love it. When that's when he said he's like, I would be here. I don't live here.
Yeah, yeah. That's what because I guess the boys, you know, Josh and Hayden and John, they've been telling him to do the show for a long time and he's like, they tell me to do it every time and I'm like, guys, I don't live in California.
So I'd love to get Zapka in here.
I think we'll get
him. We have to.
Yeah, he's the last piece.
I feel about him about how you feel about Ralph.
Oh yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, especially now. I mean, he's
just a legend.
Yeah, he's,
like
he's
and a, he's a like an athlete to the extreme
right.
and all the things. I just yeah.
Well, it was funny about him though, too, is what he was able to because Ralph Macchio was always the Daniel the Karate Kid and always carried that stardom, you know?
Yeah.
William Zabka was always like the stereotypical bully.
Yeah.
And now he's a star.
Yeah.
Now he's a star of a television show because and it's the credit to what he did. And what he's able to do, and because of that timing, and because he's able to use bits of himself, but still taking new things from this character, that character is Johnny has become one of the most beloved characters ever because he has
so
flaws.
Good. Yeah,
he has a lot of flaws.
He's super relatable.
Yeah,
yeah.
And
he's my dad on the computer. What's
oh,
Wi-Fi?
Totally. And he's so funny on that. On that one,
so
I love when they do that on Cobra Kai. Every single time when he discovers the internet for the first time.
And
so
he says dating app. He's
hot
like, yeah, I'm not doing this. With
I'll
oh,
give
she's
a,
cute.
She's a babe, he says.
Another tease, I thought that it was great when Ralph was talking about which similarities they have.
Yeah, the characters.
Yeah, super interesting to see which similarities.
He talked about Pat Morita. There's a lot. He talked about a lot. So
it was jam-packed 20 minutes.
I know. We could have easily done 2 hours with him.
100%. I was trying to push it.
I know.
That was back there.
I would start talking about The Outsiders. Outsiders is one of my favorite movies
books,
of all time.
Too.
I was bummed because I was going to open up the interview with, all right, so here's the big,
I know.
Here's
I
the
know.
Big question.
Yeah.
When is Crossroads 2 coming out?
Right.
Totally. Yes.
And it's funny, all the younger generation.
Britney Spears, baby.
Yeah. All the younger generation kept saying Britney Spears. Like, no. He hit that. He
are
hit
you his, calling me young?
Yes. Crossroads. Crossroads is not a Britney Spears original. Yeah, I know. It's on Macuga.
You just flipped your hair to nobody.
Yeah,
so
it's true.
Cody, did you see my hair flip and wink?
I did.
Nice. Thank you very much.
But the
sir.
Camera wasn't on.
Anyway, so
he saw it.
What's that? Yeah, look forward to that tomorrow, guys. It's gonna be a lot of fun.
Yeah.
The other thing too, you know, what we missed out on talking about when I realized is that because E3 was going on this week,
right?
And one of the big things that I've been looking forward to, obviously, that they showed at Celebration was Fallen Order.
Yeah.
That game looks crazy.
I love it.
It looks so good. Finally, just
do you game?
When it comes to Star Wars games, yeah, for sure. But when it's when it really relates into the story, because they haven't had many. The only one that they've done story wise to is the second Battlefront. They had a story campaign. That's the only reason I played it, because I wanted the story. And this is really cool. It's about one of the Jedi who, it's after Revenge of the Sith, and he's been on the run. And they show inside of some of this game footage, Saw Gerrera, voiced mm-hmm. again by Forrest Whitaker, is in it. So, and I liked what I saw as far as the game footage.
That's my Saw Gerrera.
That was a great noise.
Holy God. That was my Saw Gerrera.
I thought that was a soundbite.
Yeah, or a walker in The Walking Dead.
It sounded
more like a walker.
Okay. I thought it was a heat situation.
Yeah.
There you go.
Saw Gerrera.
What do you want?
What will you become?
There you go.
Yeah.
What did you say, though?
I was like, what? I don't know.
You don't know.
I was like,
yeah, Saw Gerrera got bit by a walker.
I'm Saw Gerrera. Yeah, that's
pretty good.
But Fallen Order, yeah, that was, it sounded like,
I sometimes will leave Amanda voice notes that are just me making the Walking Dead noise because she hates that show and she hates the walker noise.
Yeah. Sadie's not a big fan of the noise of that either. No. But yeah, the game looks. Did you see the game, the footage, the trailer?
Mm-hmm.
What do you think?
Sure, I loved it.
Yeah,
I loved it. It reminded me of Uncharted.
In
the Star Wars universe.
Right.
Because you get to run around, you get to like figure stuff out.
Yeah.
I love the droid hanging out on his back.
It's his buddy, yeah. They talked about that a lot
at
Celebration.
Looks up and then flies off and does his thing, and you got your lightsaber anytime you need it. Pretty cool.
I'm excited to see what happens, especially where it ends, because I don't think that they'll kill this character off yet. Because if it's successful and they can do a second one.
Is this the one that Cameron Monaghan is playing?
Yeah, that's the kid from Shameless, right? Yeah, he's the main character. Yeah.
Good dude.
You could spin off, maybe do some books, comics.
Maybe, but I think that if you're going to do a second, if the game's very popular and you want to do a second game, because you know that he can't survive for very long.
No.
Right.
Cameron Monaghan's been in here for an interview for the movie he did. I could reach out to the publicist and see if we can get
him in.
That'd be great.
In between shooting Shameless, because he's going to be a big part of this season.
Quick question for you that I've never understood. Why is he more of a household name than Lip?
Probably because of Gotham.
Gotham? Because of Joker?
Yeah.
Is that who he plays, Joker?
Yeah.
In Gotham. But it's so interesting because I still to this day don't know Lip's name.
Cameron Monaghan is more of a household name because he has played the Hollywood game a little bit better than Lip. Like, he dated Peyton List. Like, he's social media, is very social media savvy. He gets out there.
He's straight.
Yeah, I think so.
Why his character
is is gay and Shameless.
And Shameless.
Matters. I think Lip is Lip's a great actor, but Lip has
so good. Lip is ridiculous.
Yeah, he's great in Shameless. I just don't think he's done as much outside of Shameless as Cameron Monaghan.
Yes.
Do you guys? And you've never seen Shameless?
I saw a lot of the first season, and I liked it.
I would think you'd love it.
I did
like
it. I just
Same. I got into the first season. I don't know why I fell off.
It's so good.
Yeah. It's good.
Oh, I think it's one of the best shows.
The first few seasons are great, and then it takes a dip, and the last couple have been okay.
Kind of similar to Weeds.
Emmy Rossum totally. Still on the show?
Totally.
No.
This was her last season.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. How many, haven't had a season without
her. We're going to season 11, I think, right?
Wow. It's got to be.
Really?
It's got to be up there. It's got to be up there.
Macy still in
the show?
Oh, the other thing I wanted to
very much so. He's say also
is that he's the part of the show.
The other thing I want to say also is that my friend, comedian Eliza Schlesinger, who back in the day I used to watch her dog Blanche.
Me too.
I used to watch Blanche all the time.
What do you mean, like while she was out?
Yeah,
she
would go on the road and ask me if we could watch her. And Blanche passed away over the weekend. So, and
she was like 15?
Something like that. She adopted her kind of early. But Blanche became like a part of her show, and she was all over her Instagram and everything too, and Eliza was really close to Blanche. So I just went and I shot over a text the other day, just wishing her my best, and that's tough. So hearts and thoughts go out to Eliza. Give her a tweet and let her know that you guys are thinking about her.
Okay, so upcoming season is 10 of Shameless.
10.
Yeah.
Okay, that's still coming up. It's a lot, man. Uh-huh.
Remember we had Shanola Hampton in Toad Hawk?
I do.
Yeah, she was great.
She was fun.
She is the best.
She's awesome.
She's amazing.
She's
a
crazy person.
She was
great.
Cool.
She's so great in person.
Yeah. Yeah, she was. Yeah, we had her on back in the day.
I've never felt more like attacked by a person, but also like
in the best way.
In the best way. Like I think that's the hardest I've ever blushed in my life. She just came up to me and she was like, "Ooh, I like this one." And I was like, "Okay."
I blushed. I just blushed.
On the air.
Let's get her back in here too.
Yeah,
we haven't had her. I mean, that was six years ago.
Yeah.
Oh, because it's crazy.
Yeah,
crazy. We ran into when we had our little encounter with Fred.
Yeah,
it was Fred's what we're calling him, right?
Mm-hmm. The, yeah.
Because it was Bob, but then we had issues, right. So now it's Fred.
We ran into, there was this woman who was sitting with the woman who was getting entertained at the booth.
Oh, right. I'm like,
yeah, yeah, yeah. So she actually worked at Toad Hop.
Yes.
Really? Yeah, she's like, hey, yeah, because she recognized me. She's like, yeah, I worked at Toad Hop. And I was like, that is still my favorite era of shows that we ever did.
But then was it awkward? Because she then was like, I also.
She was looking for a job?
Well, yes, kind of, maybe, but she was like, I also interviewed for a position with you.
Oh, right. No, well, it was with Kristian Rubalcaba.
But about you.
About trying to get. Yeah, yeah, I don't remember. He used to sit down with everybody for interns. Looking for interns for Schmodown, by the way.
Oh, yes.
You are?
Yeah. I need somebody.
You don't have time for it.
You can't do it.
My wheels are turning.
You want to be an intern?
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool. Can you get us some coffee right now?
I think I could. I know people who'd want to intern.
Okay, let me know.
What are the hours?
It's just one day a week. It's going to be for around 3-4 hours.
What's
Thursday
the day?
Or Friday.
Mm,
yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, we'll see. Yeah, let me know.
Interesting. Wheels are turning.
Here's the other thing. Yeah, speaking of which, make sure you get tickets for the Comic-Con Schmodown.
Jumpy Croc.
How are the tickets doing?
Better, but still, it's got to wait for that schedule to come out. You gotta wait for that schedule to come out. Schmodownlive.com.
Can they put it out already?
I know.
Why haven't I gotten my pass yet? Did everybody else get theirs?
I usually go day of and just check in.
No, they send it to us now, remember?
Sometimes they do. Sometimes they don't.
Oh.
So you might just check in with your... Oh, is it gonna crack?
Right. No!
Did it, sorry.
What were we gonna do again?
No!
Where?
No!
What were we going to do again at Comic-Con? It was like a Ruth Negga's Rutabaga thing.
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't remember.
I hate when people do that. You guys.
Or that.
Stop.
Who'd you pit blast the other day? Was it Macho?
Macho.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Pit blast.
I don't know if it was better than I thought, but I don't feel bad because I got pit blasted so hard yesterday during the movie.
It's so funny.
But I don't know what it was. I don't know.
Well, she doesn't know. So she turned to me. She's like, which we're leaving. She's like, somebody smelled really bad. And I go, I'm looking. She's like, no, it wasn't you.
No,
thank
it wasn't
God.
Him.
And so she brought up somebody we were sitting next to. And I go, doesn't really smell.
No, but I didn't bring him up. He never smells the person we were sitting next to. So it couldn't have been him.
It probably came from the back.
Maybe. But I was like, am I the only one smelling it? You know when you literally, I put my head in my shirt.
I didn't smell anything. I usually pick that up pretty quick.
When I lived in Germany in the like late afternoon in the summertime, some of those buses were brutal.
As far as
the BO goes.
Yeah. You're not going to like the
Italy?
Craving.
Italy in the summertime, especially in Venice, by the water. Something about the water makes everything smell bad.
Yeah. You're not going to like the craving that I just had.
Cheese?
Blue cheese.
Yeah.
I'm craving for blue cheese.
I've been on a big blue cheese.
Delicious.
Yeah. Had a salad last night, little turkey bacon, blue cheese, strawberries, romaine.
Yeah. Cody, you're not a big blue cheese guy?
Oh, he just tweeted that.
But wait,
which is hysterical.
Oh, no, I didn't even know that you'd said that.
Last night on Twitter, I just had the realization that it's fucking awful.
What do you
thank
eat?
You,
what do you
thank
eat?
You.
What do you eat with wings?
Ranch. Ranch. I prefer ranch. They accidentally
like
gave
a
me
monster
blue last night.
I gotta put blue. Yeah, ranch.
I don't like blue cheese or ranch.
I'm finding
I eat
that
my wings
a lot lately.
With buffalo.
We're hosting a dinner party on Friday.
Why am I not invited? Can I come?
You can't find his house.
No.
Sure. You can come.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Give me your address. I've seen about 6 months. Yeah.
Come on over. I put the menu out. Any allergies, folks? And blue cheese was on the menu for the salad.
That's it.
And one email back said, can you make that goat cheese instead of blue cheese? I said, yeah, no problem.
I like goat cheese too. Yeah.
But that's not an allergy then.
Not an allergy, just a preference.
Right.
I think
both
you're
of those
cooking.
It's like half of LA with gluten.
You're cooking
it's
them dinner and they wrote back a preference?
Yeah. Yeah. That's why I asked. So I'm going to.
Right. Wait, that's horribly obnoxious, right?
No, it's not. And if you knew the person, I'm just protecting the identity. It's a well known, beloved person that I adore. And so I'm. Fuck this blue cheese. Goat cheese is going in.
Goat cheese is good.
It just what I got
you
from
don't
it
like this.
Is.
Oh no!
Is that
if
they,
I'm making you dinner? If you're allergic
cheese.
To something, no worries.
Well, they didn't say.
Or if you like hate, but say instead saying, can you put the blue cheese on the side? I would say, would you mind putting the blue cheese on the side? Can you change it out for a different cheese that I like?
I regret bringing this up because it's my friend and I'm fine with it.
I immediately
it's
regret
really
that
not
decision.
A big.
This
it's really not.
I don't know. Is it a big deal?
No, it's not a big
fucking deal.
Not a big fucking deal.
Something else.
You're doing the cooking, and they get to pick the cheese?
I mean, it's not like they said, hey, listen, I don't eat meat.
I will not come into your house and that you put goat cheese on that motherfucker.
Oh, my God. I'm so, so sorry. I really don't like blue cheese. Is there any way it could go on the side?
Yeah, no. It was a very nice ask. It was like...
Read how they asked.
No. I don't.
Because it was not a nice ask. It's really. It's a friend of mine.
I think I know exactly who it is, though.
Did I just get uninvited to dinner?
Yeah, you did.
You definitely.
You'll never be invited. Is it a
woman or a man?
It's a woman.
Is it Canon Grace?
No.
Anywhere that you put cheese.
Yes, I
put cheese on all of the things that I cook, so you can't. Yeah. It's going to be.
Is it Tom and Erica?
No.
You're not going to tell us even if you guessed?
I don't know. I guess I could. But.
Rachel and Sam.
Who was it? Was it Rachel and Sam?
I don't know.
Rachel!
It's not.
How did I call
it? Boston does it better. No, girl, no.
Well, you don't even eat cheese.
I know, so I would say.
So shut your pie hole.
Yeah, I know.
Of all the things to weigh in on,
excuse me, I'm so sorry. Yeah, but I don't eat mayonnaise, and they put mayonnaise all over my burger, and what did I do? Anything except for send it back.
Right.
Under no, like, I'm so... weird about that. Just take what you're given, try to make it work, and ask for it on the side if there's any way they could do it. Don't have somebody buy a whole different food item. Love you, Rach.
I have goat cheese.
I don't think it's a big deal at all.
No, it's not. Like I said, I regret bringing this up. If they're watching, they're going to be like, what the fuck?
Yeah, I don't think it's a big deal at all. Yeah.
Roxy, so the dinner party starts at about 11 p.m., about midnight.
I'll be there.
I live at 1486 North Highland Road.
North XYZ Road.
I'll be there. 1456.
Yeah, XYZ Road. Yeah.
North X. Yo, there is that on the way to Vegas, right?
Yeah, that's where we're having the dinner party right now.
Z-Z-Y-X.
What is Zizix? How do you pronounce it?
No, that is the road on the way to Vegas.
Yeah. How do you pronounce that? Zizix?
There's a song about it that's amazing. You guys can look it up. ZZYX. It's that song. Just type in that song.
So my RA in college, my freshman year, his last name didn't have any vowels. It was PRZBRZ, Priz Briz. That was his last name of a human being.
What?
All consonants.
Country was he from?
I have no idea. I ignored him the entire semester because he ratted me out the first day of spring semester.
What did you rat you out about?
I brought a case of beer into the dorm, and he ratted me out, and I had to like do community service.
Guys, it's a song.
Total nerd.
What? That is.
I know that song. Worst. Heard of that song. Mm.
You can't have fun in college.
Hey, you can't do it.
Cody, what were you saying?
Playing music's a little tricky on this show.
No, I don't want you to play the music.
Yeah.
Of Zizix?
No, don't play that song.
Whatever. I just said
I know that there is a song.
You guys are bullying me.
Well, yeah, definitely.
Oh, okay.
I think that's the point of the show.
I don't like cheese.
What else? There's something else I was going to bring up. I totally forgot what the hell it was. Let's just talk about...
God damn!
Yeah, I haven't talked about that in a while. Let's talk about the movie. Talk about the movie. We'll get into it. So, Men in Black 3.
Here come the Men in Black. There was none of that.
No, there wasn't.
Will Smith song?
No. But there's only like one slight reference to anything Will Smith related in the.
Yeah, but no spoilers.
No.
And by slight, you mean like literally slight.
So, here's the overall, my overall thoughts in the film. I thought that it's lighthearted. It's a family film. It's pretty generic, about as generic as you can
get.
Is it a terrible movie? No, but it's just, and there's some cute moments to it. There's this thing called the, what's it called, the thing that you like?
The Zizix.
No, the Tesseract. Prawny.
Oh.
Pawnee.
I love, that's Camille Nanjiani.
Oh, yeah, okay. So, and I was wondering.
It's that little head guy.
He was.
Well, are you talking about Camille, or are you talking about the?
Yes, I'm making a. No, it's the little head guy that's always on his shoulder.
Yes.
But that was.
I was like, I've never noticed that.
But that's the thing, though. He was really the only alien that kind of stood out to me inside that whole movie. And Men in Black is kind of famous for a lot of the.
Well, there was another alien that really stood out to me too.
Which one? Oh, the one.
Yes.
Right. But hardly in it. There's.
It stood out.
What's better, this or Aquaman?
It's a loaded question because like I like Aquaman better.
Okay.
But you don't like so it's like you know
what about this or the Pokemon
Wait,
movie?
Ask me my opinion on the movie.
Okay. I like Pokemon a lot.
I think I'll help.
Okay.
I loved the movie.
I thought it was. Men in Black 23.
I'd watch it 80 times.
But we walked out. And you said Definitely generic.
Oh,
definitely.
Super generic.
Right.
Cookie cutter. Yeah. Pretty predictable. Had no problem with
but
that.
But you thought it was, see, if
so
you think it's funny, see that thing. You think
funny,
it's funny,
fun.
You'll like it a lot more, I think, because okay. I didn't find it very funny. I thought okay. Tessa Thompson and Hemsworth are good because they're Tessa Thompson and Hemsworth. They don't sure. have any character whatsoever. I mean, okay. And at least with when Will Smith came in, they trained him
yeah.
right in the beginning. That first movie, like, he had to get trained. Sure. She just becomes an agent.
Yeah.
It's like, no, she gets trained.
Barely.
Whatever.
Come on, she didn't get trained hardly at all.
I trained her.
Oh, you did? Okay. So yeah.
the movie is awesome.
That's good.
It's so fun. Yeah, but my I had heard going
the only
into it.
The only thing that you have in the same with Tessa Thompson and training her is that it took her 20 years to find the Men in Black, and it takes you 20 years to find your
How
car
do you know that?
At the thing.
How do you know that?
Because it's in the trailer.
Oh. good one, but funny. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So
thanks, Kristian.
Why thanks, Kristian?
I don't know. I don't know what the hell's happening.
I made a joke about Tessa Thompson taking 20 years to find
the Man
in Black.
I get it. I heard. Yeah. It was so going into it. I had heard it was like an actual disaster, and I think that's why I ended up loving it. I had heard that this was going to be one of the worst movies of the year. That it was a mess.
Yeah.
That the story didn't make sense. That it was a wreck on set. So I think that's why I loved it so much, because
was
I was expecting it to be garbage,
yeah,
and it was not.
No, it wasn't garbage. I just think this one is way more of
garbage.
Yeah, kids family movie than you look at the first like three, and they're combined to kind of fit both. Mm-hmm. This one is definitely, you feel like, I was thinking about it. It was fun, 15 minutes into it, I'm like, my daughter can watch this easily,
yeah,
and probably really enjoy it.
Okay,
but Connie has a funniest one-liners. Yeah. Like, he's so good. He just says things that you're like, what?
He's
so good.
He's definitely going to win the hearts of a lot of people,
sure.
too. He's
That's their marketing.
It's like the pug. He's like the
yeah,
pug in this
totally.
One.
Totally.
And they do have a pug for like a split second. But that was the thing that I liked, the how rare and interesting that the aliens were in the first movie. Mm-hmm. And they had such a big part of it. It was just kind of like generic CGI.
Well, that's
why
I said, like, I told you yesterday when that trailer played, there was like a visceral groan from the guy in front of me who's yeah. just a casual movie fan, going like, this again,
yeah,
right.
It was you know what, it was definitely a this again type of movie.
Okay,
but you yeah. know what, you turned to me about halfway through and you said, if blah 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 happens, this is the worst written script ever. And it didn't
it
happen.
It kind of happened.
No, it did not happen.
It kind of happened.
Will Smith showed up.
In zero
Tommy
way
Lee Jones
did it
showed
happen.
Up.
That's not
Don
true.
Don Johnson
in
showed
zero
up.
Way.
It kind of happened.
No, it didn't.
It did. It did, but it didn't.
No, it literally in zero
you
way.
You guys are arguing a moot point because
you can't
spoil
say
it.
Anything. But yeah. once in like 2 weeks from now, but it's okay. like it's just something is leading up, and you're going, well, guaranteed that's going to happen, and it kind of
no.
does, and then
no.
it kind of doesn't.
That is trash.
It's not.
What you said was, if blank is blank,
and that particular thing like,
did not
didn't
happen
that particular way, but it still happened.
It didn't happen.
All right.
You guys are doing The Bachelorette from last night.
Yeah.
You really
Oh, wait.
Are.
So I heard Luke had a date or something.
He's not out, though.
So she didn't give him the rose, but he hasn't officially been, like, kicked off the show yet. He hasn't been
because
told to leave.
Didn't he end?
He's the villain, right?
But
they
what
end
she
with,
the end?
They end with him. First of all, I noticed one thing. One, he reminds me of this douchey dude I went to college with. Two, he doesn't blink. The man does not blink. He blinked. I texted Tim Geddes from Kinda Funny, who we always text about Bachelorette.
Don't blink, you might miss it.
Luke P just went, he just looked at her the whole time. No, doesn't blink. I can't even do
did
how
you
he
just call
did
him
it.
Luke Penis?
Luke P is his name on the show.
Oh.
There's Luke S.
You sound
and Luke
like
P.
you said Luke Penis, right?
So Luke oh. S cut himself off. He sent himself home at
I
the beginning of the episode.
No way.
So he's gone.
Why? Because he said he's not into her?
Wait, I knew he knew that he wasn't going to be able
he
to.
He wanted to be with all the drama.
Yeah. So. He knew he wasn't going to be able to crawl out of the hole that Luke P created. So then she kept Luke P, which we were kind of shocked about. And then we watched Game of Thrones. And then this morning I watched the end of the show. And Luke P doesn't get the rose at the end of the day. She's like, I want more from you. You need to give me emotion. And they just keep going back and forth. And this dude, he's just not smart. He's just not a smart dude. He's just a total meat stick. He has no idea what's going on. She doesn't give him
sometimes
the rose.
Sometimes you need a good meat stick.
Yeah. Snap into a Slim Jim. And so he
you know that's a soundbite, by the way.
Yeah. Everybody
it's
needs a meat
be
stick.
Now.
Yeah.
And so he doesn't get the rose, but he doesn't exactly get kicked off the show. And next week you see them like doing a bunch of stuff, and then Luke P at a church praying. So clearly something's gonna happen weird. I don't know what's gonna happen.
Praying
but,
like somebody's sick, you mean?
But here's the thing: is that there's a part where she's like, "I'm not doing this anymore." So she has a Colton meltdown next week, which I hope it is next week.
Okay. Yeah, they're probably teasing.
You're talking about the wall jump.
Yeah. I can't watch the full episode. I'm telling you, though, we'll watch Bachelor in Paradise. Like Bachelor in Paradise is a train wreck that everyone should cover on this show.
Awesome.
Yeah. It's a great train wreck. Yeah. It's okay.
That is the stuff I like.
That one you'll like.
Yeah.
You'll like that one. It's a train wreck. And we should cover it on the show during the summer because
we should cover Big Brother. You guys are not understanding.
It's so easy to find because it's on Showtime 24 hours a day.
Yeah.
It's like every single time
Big Brother?
Yeah.
It's like I watched
like 12 episodes, like last week.
But it's not on.
I know, I didn't watch any of it.
I'm waiting for the crack.
I said to her last night, I go, I'm not telling anybody, but I watched the thing. She goes, no, you didn't. I go, no, I didn't.
I like that angle, though. Yeah. You're like, I'm only going to tell you.
I'm only going to tell you.
That's true.
Right.
Right
I'm pretty gullible.
No, she knew right away. Not even for a split second. She looked like... And like do the Roxy kind of like she mess with me. She's like no. She was such a disappointed no too. She was like no, you didn't.
If you ever do actually watch the thing, I'm gonna need a notarized copy of a statement made by you and a witness. And
sure,
here it is.
You know what? I did see The Matrix though. Finally,
you're a liar.
But his face. I got Josh.
You didn't.
That smile, the way you delivered it.
I got it.
Yeah.
I got him, Cody, right?
Your camera was on him, so. Sorry about that. Oh, God, that's a walker.
That is a walker, too.
How come when Josh does it, it's cool, but when I do, it's not?
Because you just sound like you're scoffing.
Yeah.
And I... Okay, that's better. Okay. That's better.
Anyway, that was our review of Men in Black.
All right. Wait a second. It didn't do the thing. The thing did it.
You know what? I do want to see, though, what is it doing on Rotten Tomatoes right now? Any idea?
Let's guess.
I'm guessing it's going to be a 56.
I say 27.
I say 31.
I say 42.
All right. So 33. I'm
31.
31. So that was, 31.
Well, I'm surprised.
Congratulations. You win.
Let's get 32 right now.
32. Oh. So you hit 32?
People are lame. People are lame.
How many critics, though?
28.
28 critics?
56.
You just made it
74.
That's half of 56.
Do we really know?
No, it's 56. It just said it right there.
You guys kept throwing numbers out.
Where's Jeremy Johns? Put it in there. Oh, here's Bibliani. What did he say? Oh, he gave it a tomato.
He likes all. Because
it was good.
I have noticed about Bibiani watches movies very. He's got his own take.
Differently?
He just has his own take on it. Because he likes a lot of the movies that critics don't like. But you know what he does well? He explains why. I mean, I agree with him probably never. But I always respect the way that he comes out about his opinions on movies because he represents himself well inside of his opinion. Yeah. Like
there was you know who doesn't explain well?
Mara Rheinstein.
Mara from Us Weekly. The Men in Black agent zap, but they have no zip.
Well, you didn't read her whole review.
I don't know what
means. That's just a quote.
That's just a tag.
That's just a quote. That's not her full review.
All right, sorry, Mara, baby.
Yeah, so...
Donde está Bibliani?
But click on Bibliani for a second.
Wait, we told Bibliani yesterday, and he was not happy.
No, he didn't like...
He doesn't like Bibliani?
No, he's been getting it all his life. He's not a big fan of the Bibliani.
Dang it.
No, not the actual article itself. I want to see his, like... Yeah, click on his name. I would like to see, like, if you go... See, he gave... So he gave a fresh to Men in Black International. I didn't see fun. Secret Life of Pets 2 is on. Dark Phoenix, he gave a rotten to. Okay. Domino, let's see, Maki, Godzilla. Godzilla.
What are you looking for right now? What did he give Rotten to? He gave Aladdin rotten. Aladdin is 56%. Are you guys all on crack?
Brightburn.
No, clearly not a good movie.
Keep going down.
Same with Godzilla.
John Wick 3.
Okay, so.
Morning Meeting Gorbachev.
Keep going. Hellboy, see, 17% of critics hated that movie. He gave it a fresh.
No, 17% of critics
hated it.
No, 17% liked it.
No, 17% hated it.
No.
70% liked it.
17%, excuse me, right, liked it. 70% of the,
gave a positive.
Yes. So, and keep going. So then there's, I don't know what that is.
Disney
Adventure. Wonder Park. There's another 34%. He liked it. Green Book. He didn't like. But that's. Yeah, I was thinking about that today. A lot of critics didn't like that. Happy Death Day 2, most people. So Alita. See, Alita, though. Alita liked. I liked Alita.
Lego Movie 2.
Yeah, so we're on the same page.
Orange is the Alien.
Yeah. Anyway, Cool. Vice is another one. Yeah, so we're there. You go, Aquaman.
Should I stop calling him Biblioni now?
Yeah. Okay. Yes. He doesn't want us to. So it's fair. We can't call Alex.
Can't call
Alex Chips.
I still call him Chips in my head.
Yeah.
But you want to know what I have to respect about Alex a lot.
What?
Alex is the only one of you guys who respected my wishes. Oh. It's his birthday.
Oh, I thought it was your birthday.
What?
I thought it was your birthday. I thought you were saying he was the only one of you guys that remember my birthday.
I thought you said you were okay, Spider.
The only one that respected my wishes and calls me RJ.
Oh, RJ.
Just doesn't stick.
My birthday is July 13th. I'm a Cancer.
I'm a big initials guy. Like TJ, RJ, BJ.
Just doesn't stick.
What's your middle name?
Edward.
J-E sucks.
You gotta need a JT.
How did I not know
Edward? How about Jem? But he's Jem.
The three of us.
Jem is dope.
But you are Jem.
Jem. Did anybody call you that?
Yeah.
Oh.
What up, Jem?
Who?
Jem my mom dog. Used to call me Jem in the Holograms, nice. But that was a female show, so my dad wasn't a super big fan of that.
Jem Dog.
Jem.
Yeah. Jem Rock.
Jem Rock.
What are your guys' initials?
KGH.
What's the G for?
George.
Off my
Where the hell have you been?
What do you mean?
Mark
Ellis calls me that every 5 minutes.
Well, KG is like the best nickname ever.
KGB.
My family calls me that.
KG is amazing. What about you?
Edward is my middle name. Just like him.
Mur.
Me, Emmy. Ellis, and Josh and are all middle names.
And his sister is Frankincense.
What? Wait, what? I hate this. Does anybody at home get it?
This is my daughter Frankincense and Myrrh. They're going on the road together. The Reilly kids, Frankincense.
They ride camels everywhere.
There it is.
It's Wednesday.
Ooh. Oh, they're having fun. Let them have their fun,
I'm
Roxy.
Letting them. I've been told.
That was such a Macuga, too.
Yeah. I love that joke so much.
I'm glad you guys are having fun.
Oh, Frankincense and Mother. Mother Muggy.
We also need some booty song.
Yeah.
Always. Booty, thank you.
Riley, let's go to news. What's
somebody
going on
in the
news?
Facebook group wrote something weird about the booty song. They said that somebody else said, like, I got depressed, so I lost my booty on Facebook, and they just attached this link.
The lyrics, right? Yeah. Yeah, that was funny. Yeah, I saw that. What else is going on in the world of news?
Well, there's some news coming out of Star Wars The Rise of Skywalker that it's being edited on set because of the tight schedule. And I find that interesting. It happens sometimes in big movies. And
wouldn't people get excited about that?
I would think so.
It's like, because it doesn't mean like you're not paying attention. Like, hold on, guys, can't shoot this scene. I'm editing some dialogue.
There's just a guy behind them basically like catching up. Like when they're editing on set, they're just doing live edits so the dailies look better.
They map out their schedule and say, okay, look, if they have the footage. Cool. They're editing while we're filming. Yeah. It doesn't mean anything.
It means nothing.
Why do you say it like people are mad? Have you heard?
Oh, I got a Twitter where I just shook my head and I'm like, this movie's gonna fucking tank. And I was like, from editing on set?
Yeah. No, editing on set happens all the time.
Means they took a longer time to write and craft, which is probably better.
No, better.
And if you have, as long as you have a blueprint. And you know, like, okay, we need to get this done. We have all this footage to make sure this happens, too. And editing on set, I mean, what's the difference between editing on set and editing in an office? You just have an office on set.
Exactly. And I think they
set up an editing bay.
I think they think that it's like, done. It's like, oh, we're editing and we move on. It's like, no, you're going to go back to post. And
yeah, it's just being able to have a rough copy of the film so then you can go back and that to me is...
They may have a blueprint, but they don't have the blueprint too. Jay-Z's right. Oh, thanks, guys.
Okay, appreciate see you later, Josh.
I got your blueprint joke.
Yeah,
thanks, guys.
Yeah, it's all right.
Hit my jam, Cody.
Just
do the Meryl Streep yell.
I feel like you made that joke the other day too, though.
Thank you. That's going to be my ringtone when Amanda calls.
That's great. That's good. Although you should make that your total ringtone for anything and just leave it on high blast anywhere you are.
Yeah. Yep.
it's really a great
one. Do you think it's really Meryl? Scream.
Yeah, yes. 100%.
Yes.
Yeah.
She won an Oscar for that scream.
Yeah,
but I know when you're shooting that many takes to be able to do that, it's hard.
Yeah, well, they probably just used one that was really good.
Yeah,
Yeah.
One take down.
I mean, it's Meryl Streep, man.
Yeah. Hey, Meryl, you're going to yell, let's get this in one. I got it. It's effing Meryl Streep. I like this shot. I want this shot. It's done.
Speaking of which, I mean, I know we don't really talk about basketball too much on the show, but I mean, how do you feel about them putting KD in there, man? Was that a bad move?
Oh, obviously it's bad.
Yeah, it's bad.
I mean, 2020.
Well, yes, but I mean, obviously badness is because from what everyone's saying is that the team was pressuring him, teammates were pressuring him, and that
media.
And the media, yeah. And if you don't go in, you're a wimp, you didn't help win, like all those things, but obviously he needed more time.
And now his injury's even worse.
For a year.
Well, here's the thing. Out for a year. Is that and Tom can tell you this because he ripped his Achilles. Yeah. Anybody that has ripped their Achilles, the Achilles is not a muscle, so it can't heal. If you're about to rip your Achilles, there's nothing you can do. Like, it's going to burst.
Right. Yeah.
So, here you go. So the fact that it was a calf strain and everybody was calling it Achilles because when he first fell down, he reached right at his Achilles. It was I keep making the comparison. It's like in Cliffhanger when they were cutting the string and the twine was popping?
Yep. Yeah.
That's exactly what his Achilles tendon was doing. And the doctors and everybody should have been like, listen, this is what's going to happen. But they didn't. They were calling it a calf strain because they wanted to keep the hope alive. And then he was awesome. Then it was a ticking time bomb.
That's it.
And the doctor should have said,
what was it, like 12 points in 11 minutes or something?
Yeah. At the beginning of the second quarter, he tried to make a move. Tendon pops. Yeah. There you go. It's gone. It's a year, it's year off.
A year.
And everybody, this whole offseason was, where is Kevin Durant going to go? Where is Kevin Durant going to go? No team is going to step onto an aging basketball player, still in his prime. I mean, he's still probably the greatest basketball player right
27,
now.
27, 28?
No, he's 30.
Is he 30 now?
I think
And with an Achilles injury, which is not easy to come back from, just ask any athletes that rip their Achilles, to then pay him a super max contract.
30, yeah.
I bet he would imagine. I would imagine he stays in Golden State because I don't think any team
is
going to pay him a super max for a year off.
Yeah. You know? So what happened to, like, because Derrick Rose started to get broken down, too.
Yeah. So you don't know what happens after Kobe a year, Bryant. Also. You don't know what
but Kobe Bryant, Kobe Bryant had a big run for, like, a long time.
But then
long
he ripped his Achilles.
No, I know, but I'm just saying he had a lot longer of a run is where Derrick Rose was supposed to be one of the best, and he just was plagued by injuries.
Yeah.
So. It's awful.
It's the worst injury in sports because even with Tommy John and ACL and MCL and all that stuff, depending on how it is, as far as you... There is no rush to heal from Achilles. You can't. You can't.
So it's over, right? So Raptors, what's it, 3-1?
No. It's 3-2.
There's two
games left. I think now Golden State is pissed that Toronto cheered when he went down.
Oh, yeah.
Because
that
Toronto
was insane.
Was cheering when he fell down.
Which is the exact opposite of sportsmanship. Yeah.
Right. Totally. Mm-hmm. And then...
Do you think they knew the severity of it?
Yes.
Dude, there was
Everybody knew going into the game.
That he was banged up.
Yeah.
They're taking every precaution. You got to blame the team. You got to blame the doctors. There's a little bit of blame on KD, but he's still the athlete. For him to say, like, I feel ready to go.
Yeah, I blame him the least.
He's always going to say that.
He's always going to say that. You're an athlete.
Like, the great players, they're warriors, and they're like, they'll play.
Yes.
It's the responsibility of the coach, the responsibility of the owners to say, let's protect our guy, not only because we want him to be healthy next season, it's because he's a human being.
Health,
let's not break down
health
this guy's
for
career.
The rest of his life and his career. That's why you need steroids.
Yeah. They're talking about sports, Cody.
What is it, Ken?
Come on.
You're on, Ken.
I'm home making a freaking flapjack egg breakfast here, and I hear you jackholes accusing me of not liking blue cheese, Harloff. I heard it.
I know.
I was your guest, and I call Reilly. He's like, could you hold the blue cheese? I eat gas station sandwiches, Ken.
Wait, Ken, does that mean you agree with me that somebody shouldn't ask for a different type of cheese?
I think there's a problem with it, but, you know, I don't think it's a huge thing if Reilly asks it. You know, if Reilly's like, hey, do you like celery?
Made a point.
I'd be like, what am I?
Made a point.
You know, a mook here? No. But I'm just offended that Kristian got this little look on his face. He's like, I know who it is. It was Ken, right?
Oh, yeah.
I food off the tabletop.
I've seen it.
Fair. It's a good point. I stand corrected.
The first sandwich you ever ate at Comic-Con was off the carpet of a Hyatt.
That's true.
Is that true?
Yeah.
Yeah. Daddy ate my sandwich.
No, yeah, it was a meatball sub.
A meatball sub
from Subway.
Exactly. Yeah. And the story that night is Kristian goes, let's go to a nice restaurant. I'll take you to Fish Place. We end up at a Subway. Did I complain? I was like, no, footlong Subway Club, please.
And I'll eat it. And I'll eat it right here.
This was so confusing because it is so motherfucking loud out there that I thought Ken's voice was just, I thought Ken was just talking really loud out there. Can they hear that? Can you guys at home hear that?
We can all
hear
it.
Yeah, sure.
The one Comic-Con, Ken and I ate upwards of 100 Doritos cheese bites.
I remember that walk back. Oh, that was like the 20th helping that weekend.
Ooh. Yeah, I remember.
It's also why I have a doctor's appointment today at 3, but it's another conversation.
Yeah, all right, well, Ken Napsok, I'm sorry to think that you would be asking for anything else.
I never believed you. It was you, Ken.
Yeah.
Just to be clear.
All right. I love you all.
Goodbye, Ken.
Bye, Ken.
I still think it was him.
Pit Bull. I hold true. Yeah. It was Ken requesting goat cheese. I don't want to throw my co-host of the afternoons under the bus, but I don't think I've ever heard Ken say the words goat cheese in my life.
Goat cheese is delicious. You know, I put it on. I put it on barbecue chicken pizza. CPK.
I'm pretty sure during the truffle pumpers conversation, there was a goat cheese side.
It's possible.
Mm. Almost didn't want to get it. Just reminded me of Dagnino walking back into the studio. He said the truffle pumpers. Dagnino. What time is it?
It is 10:55.
All
right, look, let's go to break. We'll do the rest of the news after we have our guests in.
Yeah.
We are going to have director Josh Cooley and producer Jonas Rivera and Mark Nielsen in to talk about Toy Story 4.
Hey, Kristian, how's it feel?
You're going to piss them off. You're going to piss them off. All right, we'll be right back.
How would you do that?
All right. Got to lay some fucking ground rules here, Alex. You hearing this shit?
Hey guys, Reilly here, and let me tell you about Rule of Two. You looking for a Star Wars fix? Well, Rule of Two is that show. It drops on Collider Video's main YouTube channel, as well as on Podcast One's Jedi Council feed. So go over there, subscribe, share it with your friends. It's hosted by myself and Mark Fernandez. We talk everything in the Star Wars universe with a lot of deep dives and a lot of conversations that go all in. You know what to do. Subscribe, join us there, and rise.
Hey everyone, John Rocha here, the host of Collider Mailbag. New episode drops every Saturday and Sunday in your face and in your ears, answering the questions from you fans about the world of entertainment, film, and television. Me and great guests from our sphere do the best to answer your questions from Twitter, from Instagram, and of course, email as well, every Saturday and Sunday.
Hi, I'm Koi Jandro, host of Collider Heroes, and I'm here to tell you we've got 20-minute episodes coming at you on Collider Video, on the YouTube, as you've always loved it. Plus, now we've got hour-long podcasts dropping every Thursday, so make sure to subscribe to the podcast because it's going to get even more sweaty on the podcast. Plus, every week we're going to try to get some very special guest interviews, all of the people that help shape these movies and TV shows you love. So, video, podcast, interviews all coming at you. Be sure to subscribe. Thanks so much, guys. Stay sweaty.
Hey guys, Perry Nemiroff here to let you know that The Witching Hour is all over Collider right now. You can listen to that horror-filled podcast with myself, with Haley Fouch. We talk about witchiness, we talk about slashers, we talk about space horror, you name it, all on that show on the Collider Factory feed. We also have clips on the Collider Podcast YouTube channel, and on top of that, you can find an article all about Witching Hour every single Tuesday on Collider.com. Check it out. Get scared. Hopefully you survive the witching hour.
What's up, Collider fans? Ryan Satin here from ProWrestlingSheet.com, where you can find the top stories throughout the week in the world of professional wrestling. If you're a wrestling fan like myself, then you'd be doing yourself a disservice by not checking out all the shows we do every week on YouTube.com/C/WrestlingSheet. In particular, on Wednesdays, we've got a SmackDown recap show hosted by John Rocha and myself, where we pick apart and talk about every little thing that happened on the Blue Brand. So do yourself a favor and go subscribe at youtube.com/C/WrestlingSheet.
Hey guys, Perry here to let you know about the new edition of Collider Movie Talk. We are going to 5 days a week. We have a short, sweet 20-minute show where we focus on the two biggest stories of the day. You can expect to see all of your favorite Collider personalities on the show, including Jeff Snyder, John Rocha, Haley Fouch. You're getting Josh Macuga every Friday. We're going to have a blast. It's going to be informative, fun. Come join us. 3 p.m. PT live every single day of the week, right here on the Collider Video YouTube channel. You can also find the show on the Collider Movie Talk feed on our podcast network, so go watch, go listen, however you prefer to get all of your movie news.
Hey everyone, John Rocha here, the host of Collider Sports Time. Well, you know, if you've been watching us every week, you know we break down the latest and the greatest in the world of sports, talk about the big issues, the big games, all of it with a rotating band of guests like Matt Nose and Josh Macuga. We've had Taylor Bisciotti on. We've had so many great guests. Now, if you want to see more of Sports Time or you want to try it out for the first time, remember to subscribe to Collider Sports YouTube channel. And if you want to take us along with you in your ears, you can go and subscribe to the Collider Sports podcast feed for all the sports goodness.
Hey guys, it's Riley here. Let me tell you about the Riley Roundtable. You know it, right? It drops every Thursday on Collider Conversations, and I have guests from all across the space. John Rocha, Gray Drake, Alexander Desplat came on at one point. We talk everything from movies, we talk about life, and everything in between. What do you want to hear? What do you want to talk about? It's the Riley Roundtable every Thursday on Collider Conversations. You get it there.
Hello, how are you guys doing? I'm Kristian Harloff. I'm the host of Collider Jedi Council. We talk about everything Star Wars, and if you want to catch our weekly show where we talk about the latest and greatest in Star Wars, it's movie news, it's canon, it's all of it. We take questions from you guys. How do you do it? Main channel, that's right, right here. Subscribe to this channel, and you can listen, you can watch, you can do all of it. But if you want to just listen to it, you got the podcast feed too. Stitcher, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, whatever it is, you can listen to it in your car. Do all of it. It's Star Wars. Episode 9 is coming out, and then after episode So 9, you got TV shows, so we're going to be your sports center for Star Wars. Do it. Come on. Be real.
We are back, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for joining us back on Collider Live. As you know, one of the most iconic movies of all time is the Toy Story franchise in general. It's just such a great franchise. We all grew up with it. We love it. And Toy Story 4, it is coming out next week. And joining us in studio right now is the director of the film, Josh Cooley. And we have producers Jonas Rivera and Mark Nielsen joining us. Thank you guys for joining us today.
Thank you for having us.
Great to be here.
Listen, this is exciting because, first of all, I got to... your work on Inside Out in general... from directing Riley's First Date and all that. I mean, did you ever imagine that, because obviously being involved in Pixar, it's a great place to be involved, but that they were going to give you Toy Story, which is one of the biggest franchises maybe all time?
Yeah, no pressure.
Yeah, right?
I mean, yeah. Right after Inside Out, I was asked to come on Toy Story 4, and I love those characters so much. I mean, we all do. We say how Toy Story is... weaved into the fabric of Pixar, and it's such a big, important movie and characters to us, and we just love it so much. And so, to take that on was just huge. I still can't really believe it.
Right.
I just put so much pressure on myself more than anybody else, and I don't know. I love working with these guys. Work with them on Inside Out as well,
right.
And all the way back to Cars, even. So it feels like family working with everybody.
Well, so how does it come about? Like when because Disney, they're so good with franchises and with Toy Story, and a lot of people had said, because 1, 2, and 3 were like the perfect trilogy.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people were like, oh, do we need to do another one?
Right. Too?
And so when the fourth one, how does it come to be? Who has the idea to say, is it Iger? Does he go, we're doing Toy Story 4, boys? Or like, how does that work?
Well, first we even said the same thing. We thought 3 was the end.
We used to joke that we thought 2 was the end.
Right.
But I think it was really Andrew Stanton.
Yeah.
From my memory, he was the one that kind of first. I think even when we were finishing 3, he was secretly scrolled away coming up with a basic outline for fourth one.
Right.
And he told us he had never seen the third as the end. He said no, it's a great ending. It's a powerful ending. But that's Andy's ending. That's the ending of that relationship between Andy and Woody. And there's more after that. There's more. That's one test.
Right.
But he was always curious, and that was just the nugget of the idea of like what happens after that. Woody did everything right. He landed on his feet, but this is not going to be the same. Bonnie's not the same as Andy, and he wanted to see. And then that kind of lit us up. We did too. Like, what would he do if it wasn't the same?
Right.
What if he wasn't in first chair, so to speak? And that question, what would that be like? got us to kind of sit forward with, that is cool. What if you could pop up, you know, and then it started to bounce around and it started to turn into what we've made.
Is it so nerve-wracking taking on this job, even after you hear the direction that you guys are going in, that you debate saying no at some point?
You know, we it is nerve-wracking, absolutely, and for, not just for us, for the entire crew. We just wanted to be, we wanted to feel just like another adventure. Like, there has to be a point for the film. And I think we, every step of the way, we're kind of like, well, we're not going to make something that isn't worthy of the title Toy Story 4. So that was always the goal. Like, it has to feel in line with these other three films, but also continue the adventure that with these characters we know.
And the crew, too, they love these characters so much. They really stepped up, and they brought everything to it. We've got people on the crew that were part of the first one, all the way back to the first Toy Story. And then we've got people on the crew that were, like, age three. First movie they ever saw was Toy Story. Yeah. Inspired them to get into animation, and they're working on it, animating these characters, which was really cool.
Well, it changed the game. I mean, I remember it changed the game. I was working at a movie theater when it came out. It was, like, 95, right?
Yeah.
When the first one came out. And I remember seeing the trailers over and over and over again in the movie theater, and it was just because it was the old school animation was still the main thing, but then there was this new animation coming out. What is this? It looks fantastic. Oh my god. And then you see it, and it was the movie that I would say built Pixar. Really was.
For sure. Yeah.
It was the movie that put everything on the map. So to do four of them, and like you, and it's refreshing, and you obviously know that because of just Pixar's background, that you want to put all the time and the effort into it. It's not just a cash grab, and I don't think that anybody really felt that, because you can't do that. You can't do that to Woody. You can't do that to Buzz.
Right.
There's just too
much.
We'd
rather not do it. If that's what it was.
Right. Mm-hmm. So what do you think the most satisfying part of is? And I assume this is the closeout of the franchise. Maybe no. Who knows? Yeah, but
well, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just gonna say, what do you think is the most satisfying part of your experience making this film?
Wow, well, that's a bigger question than I thought you were gonna ask.
Yeah.
most satisfying part. I think that I'm very happy that we have completed Woody's arc, and I think with three being the end of Woody's time with Andy, that this fourth one people will see, like, oh, there is more story to tell. And it does feel like a completion for Woody.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever happens after this, I'm not even thinking about that. This just feels that our goal was like this: the 1, 2, 3, and 4 feels like a complete story.
When you say there's more story to tell, do you mean that there has been a conversation about a Toy Story 5?
No, I mean after Toy Story 3, there was more story to tell with Woody.
Got it.
So that's what Toy Story 4 is.
Yeah, I think I found it really satisfying. Just to tag on to that. That people seem to come to it with a little bit of, and we did too when we were making it, with a little bit of doubt. Like, three was so good, this one can't be that, right? And even the cast, like even Hanks and Tim, like when we brought them in and pitched, and you first pitched the kind of basic shape of this, it was Tim almost was like, hey, let's see what you guys got. Okay, you know, I'm Buzz, let's do it. And then by the time you were done pitching, his body language changed, and I think he even said, oh man, okay, like you got, and with that, just seeing that in those guys, Tom did the same thing.
And that was the test.
Our crew did the same thing, like we started doing the same, so there's this, to answer your question, like to me the most rewarding thing has been, there's this little bit of delta between what people think it is to what it really is. It's been really rewarding, and it's even surprised me and us, I think. It's you know what I mean?
Yes, absolutely. Because I was just going to ask you, I was just hearing you talk about that, because I think that was in Toy Story 3 when they're all laying, it looks like they're about to go and they're about to all burn up. I teared up. I mean, everyone teared up. How many times am I going to cry in this movie? Is what I want to know.
I don't know. I hope three and a half.
I think that also is
three. It's very specific.
Three and a half. That's probably 20 for you.
That's probably 20 for you. For sure.
Going back to what you said, though, who of the cast was the most hesitant at first to come back?
I don't think any more hesitant to come back. I think that you get, you know, people think about a sequel, and I think there was just a little bit of a built-in, like, oh, okay, let's do another one. And we were there to say, that's not what this is. This isn't just let's do another one. This is... our goal was, once you saw this, that you could not imagine the saga without it, right? And so it was just, none of them came like, we're not going to do it, or, you know, any of that. They were all really cool, but we could just sense a little bit of, we've been there before, and we watched that erode.
Right. Yeah, because we're working on these things for a long time before we ever introduced the script to the cast.
What's a long time?
5 years total.
Wow.
Yeah, 5 years total for the film, but before the cast hears it, it's even a year and a half, maybe 2 years before they're reacting to it. And so there's always a little bit of hesitation and like, how are they going to take this when we pitch it to them?
This movie's been in the works for 5 years. Is that
right? Yeah.
Wow.
That's great.
Yeah.
It's great because it's just, you can tell how much time and effort and it really and love kind of goes into it, because you don't want to spend 5 years on something you're just going to go, there it is. Right. All right, what's next?
Exactly.
Yeah, it's a hunk of our lives. You know?
Right. Yeah. It's a big thing. And like I said at the beginning of the interview, it's because it's just beloved franchise that you want to close it out well. So let's get into a little bit as far as, obviously I don't want to know anything about the actual spoilers or anything, but as far
I don't
far,
think they could tell us anyway.
No, I don't, but I don't want them to, but as,
we haven't seen the movie yet.
But as far as like, for people that maybe they don't know the full story, I know that we have, so the Fork's name, the Spork, right?
Yeah.
His name is?
Forky,
okay. Mm-hmm. So Forky now is built by Bonnie, mm-hmm. and then gets lost, and Woody's got to go find him, and I think that's, to me, when I saw that, I was like, okay, they're taking a nice little element from Toy Story 1, but then throughout that trailer, I was like, but this is different.
Yeah.
This is different. So what can you say that's different about 1 and 4, and what can we expect from Woody and the crew in this one?
Yeah, the funny thing about, I think the thing that's funny about Forky is that, you know, in the first Toy Story, Buzz was like the coolest toy ever. Like, that's how he's advertised. We went the opposite way and made the crappiest toy ever. Like, he's literally garbage. And where Woody in the first film is jealous and will push him out the window, we did the opposite, which is he's evolved over these four films. He can't just be jealous again, because it would just feel like we're redoing it all again. Yeah. So he's...
It's like Lenny and Sam?
He's seeing how much Bonnie really cares about this thing, and we're looking at our own kids for reference. Our kids make stuff all the time, and you're like, why are you holding on to this? It's just an egg carton caterpillar, or hand turkey, or whatever it is. Right. But he sees how important this toy is to Bonnie, and he's willing to go to any length to get him back. And so he's doing it for the right reasons, and it kicks off into a whole another adventure in a way he doesn't even see coming. So. I'm so happy with the way it's been advertised, because people haven't seen anything.
Yeah.
I'm so happy about that.
If the goal is to make the crappiest toy, what were the other pitches that were on the table? Like, we got Forky, but what else did you guys throw around?
In terms of a crappy toy?
Yeah, in terms of crappy toy.
You know what's
toy?
Funny? A spork was the first thing we drew, and everybody in the room just kept drawing sporks, just because it's such a funny, weird thing, I guess.
And so it's sort of a kid thing, like a kid, our kids eat Jello and mac and cheese with spork. Kids, we're all parents, and so our kids always have sporks. But the idea was basically that my kid plays with anything. He would be like, hi, what's going on? To this glass of water. Right. Everything's a little toy, or a napkin is a gun, or whatever. And that made us laugh and question, like, is that a toy? Is that a toy just because a kid says it? And, so we chased that down, and there was Forky.
Who voices Forky?
Tony Hale. Yeah.
So when you guys are coming up with the idea of Forky, who is like, how do you know, like, this is the kind, this is the voice that we need, this is the actor that we need? Like, how do you know?
I'm a huge fan of his. Yeah. I mean, Arrested Development is genius, and so is Veep. And just when we were talking about this character being a piece of trash that all of a sudden comes to life and has never seen Toy Story 1, 2, or 3, so he doesn't understand any of the rules of the world. Like, he'll get up and walk around while the kid's there in the room.
Yeah.
And he'll, one version of the movie we had where he actually would try and talk to Bonnie and stuff, and the toys are like, stop it, you don't know what you're doing. Did that idea of somebody who doesn't understand it and is innocent to the world and also just needs to be funny, I'm like, God, that's Tony Hale.
You requested it.
Usually we listen to a bunch of voices, but Tony was right out the gate. We were like, it's got
to
be him.
And I think, Jonas, it was you that called them to kind of tell him about the role and offer it to him. And you're like, this is a character that doesn't really understand why he's alive. And he's like, check, got it. I want to hear that.
I'm in.
Right. It's also, I think, when you approach an actress, too, that it helps, obviously, really call for Pixar is one. Two, the fact that, hey, it's Toy Story 4. And three, that you have a role that's pretty layered and fun.
I think you're right, but we were like, what does Pixar do? It's Toy Story 4. It's a big character. And here's the character, and it's literally a spork with googly eyes on it. We're grateful that he was okay with that.
What did he say when you offered it to Tony?
Oh, he was honored. I mean, he's such a gentleman, and he's so cool, and
he's the best.
Proud to be part of it, and wanted to do justice to it and all that.
Yeah.
So he was really touched.
I want to go back to something that you said before, Josh, that I agree with you to where I think that a lot of times that studios are guilty of showing too much in trailers. Mm-hmm. And I think that you for some reason you don't trust the audience that they're not going to respond to the story. It's or just like bits of it, or and they give the whole story and they give spoilers. And I haven't seen that in this movie. And I hadn't seen that in a lot of even I thought they did a very good job with Endgame, because Endgame I didn't get a lot of the
Endgame. Same team, by the way, that worked with us. They're amazing in Disney marketing. And they only showed, they only used stuff from the first 15 minutes of the movie for all their trailers. I remember reading that somewhere, which is incredible. Yeah.
These guys are great. I mean, they reach out to, they work with us. So it's not just the Disney marketing team picks it up and tells us what they're doing.
You guys have a say.
Yeah, they come to us and we have conversations and, you know, we go, that's a little too far. Or that's, what about the, and they're really collaborative and we're pleased with it. I mean, it's,
that's good,
it's
because really you, well you, done. I worked a long time ago for Joel Silver in the Warner Brothers system, and it's like, you know, and you would see sometimes trailers were just the opposite of that. It was, this is what it is, and the directors were like, that's, you're just showing way too much, guys. So it's refreshing to hear that you guys say that.
We just say, like, these five things we really want to steer clear of. We want to hold back on that, and they totally respected that as we worked with them.
Awesome.
It's probably a really fine line, though, between showing too much and not showing enough. The Frozen trailer just dropped.
Yeah.
And a lot of people were saying, but what's it about afterwards? Right. How did you guys feel about the Frozen trailer?
Isn't that what people should be saying? I mean, I think of, like...
I didn't have a problem with it.
Yeah, I think that's... I kind of hope that eventually the trailers start to go back that direction where it's like Alien or Shining, where you're like, I have no idea what I just saw. Right. I have no idea what this movie is about.
I know who's in it, but I want to see it. Yeah.
I
mean, we're not marketers, but we respond to trailers that we love. And, you know, it's a really fine line and it's a really tough art. And I don't know how they do it, but we were pleased with what they did with this.
Yeah, my thought was always that if it's a movie, it's a property or an IP that you don't really know, that maybe you show a little bit more of the story to let people know what it is. But a property like Toy Story or Star Wars or
Frozen, even.
Frozen, for sure. Because people are going to see Frozen. They're going to see Toy Story.
We talked, and this is not in just the marketing, but in the making of the movie. It's like what we wanted it to be was a little bit of a cocktail of like, the nostalgia and the things you remembered as a kid and growing up with Toy Story and working in that theater and seeing that first trailer and all that stuff, Randy Newman, but pivoted in a way that you've never seen it.
Right.
There's elements and there's ingredients and there's sounds and music that's completely different. And so we leaned into that from the story to the post, you know, all the way through marketing.
Well, go ahead, Ron.
Something we talked about a lot actually on Collider Live, going back to Forky for a second, is... what kind of toy would come out about Forky? Is it going to be an actual spork? Was it going to be a plush? How are they going to do this? Are you guys, when you're making the movie, thinking about, okay, how is this going to sell? Is this going to be a toy that kids are going to like? Does that come into your mind at all?
Absolutely not. I mean, it's hard enough just to figure out the story. And that's a whole nother level that I'm not even smart enough to think that far. You know, of course, I love toys. I have a big toy collection, so... something like Duke Kaboom, when we're finally making them, like, God, that they are going to make a toy of this. I know that. And I want that. But it's not built into how are they going to sell it later. You know?
We think about, like, we hope these are characters people will love.
Right.
And more often than not, that translates. I mean, I think with Forky, we may have even said when we met with the consumer products people, like, we're sorry. Like, here's our...
Good luck.
They loved it.
They started to panic.
Yeah.
What was done really well, and I think it was the third one, right, was when Michael Keaton shows up, right?
Yeah.
And Michael Keaton shows up, and it's a great new addition. And this time, you got Keanu Reeves showing up. And people... Yeah. This is like... And our good friend Janine had said that this is the Keanu-sance, right? So this year, he's just been doing... So many great things. And from what I'm hearing is that he just kind of steals the show and kind of comes in here as the stuntman, right? Like, well, so what was the idea we were talking about before with Tony? What was the idea with the thought process of trying to go to get Keanu?
Well, we had the character, which was Duke Kaboom, Canada's greatest stuntman. And so we only looked at Canadian actors for this. And the way we cast voices, we have a department that brings us a bunch of recordings and we just listen and we don't want to look at faces. We don't want to know the names of the characters. We just want to hear the voices because you're obviously not going to see their faces on screen.
Can you tell a lot of the time though who's the voice behind it?
You know, sometimes you can and sometimes you can't, but in this case we were listening to things and Keanu's voice came up and we all three of us went, whoa, hold on, who, like, that's amazing. And it was a line from a Keanu movie I had never seen. So when you're not looking at his face, he doesn't click immediately. And so they were like, this is Keanu. And we just kind of, we were laughing, going, well, he'll never say yes. And but we reached out to him anyway. And
why did you think he wouldn't say yes?
Because it's a side character. It's not, you know, we just didn't know. We've never met him before, right. But it was a side character. And we reached out to him just to see. And he said, well, let me come to Pixar and meet with you guys. And so he came up by himself and just had lunch with us at up in Emeryville. And we were sitting at the table, and I was pitching him the story, and we were just talking about the character. And he says, well, you know, what is he afraid of? Like, what is it? Like, asking these really deep questions, like, who are his friends? Like, what is he? Like, these questions, I'm going, man, I did not think of this stuff because this is really deep. Like, right. He's getting really deep questions. Yeah. But it was fantastic. And he started going, like, I think, Jonas, you said, like, he's one of those characters, he's an action figure. He does in poses and stuff. He's yeah. like, oh, poses, okay. And he went, huh, huh. And he started doing.
Oh, I wish poses. You guys would have recorded that.
Oh, oh, I wish. It's stuck in my brain. Yeah, man. But he was becoming the character yeah. to the point where he would get so excited. He stood up on the table in the middle of our lunchroom.
On top of the table.
On top of the yes, table. And was going, I'm Duke Kaboom. And people are like, is that Keanu Reeves standing on the table? But he became that character.
He's really in it. That's yeah. cool.
And
he's a thoughtful, thoughtful actor.
It's all in yeah. the movie. He said yes to the role, and I was like, that is Duke Kaboom. That all has to be
in. We didn't even know how much he loves motorcycles either, and that he owns his own motorcycle company. That was a nice coincidence.
Yeah.
His character
yeah.
is like a stuntman that rides yeah. a motorcycle.
He just seems like the coolest dude on the planet. He just really
he
does.
He had so actually. Much fun yeah. truth. Recording. Yeah. He just was so excited. I could just see it. He had a huge smile on his face whenever we'd meet with him, and we just had so much fun working with him.
That's awesome. Yeah,
he's one of those guys, just to say, because yeah. he's one of those guys that treats everyone, you know, from the second assistant editor to the engineer to producer and director, sort of the same. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's just what you always hear guys. About him. You hear about that all the time. He's yeah. just super nice to the crew. And I can't remember who it was, but said something along those lines. You just got to always, you respect everybody the same exact way. He just has that kind of philosophy.
He's a gentleman.
Yeah, that's what everyone says. That's awesome, man. That's yeah. cool that you guys got him involved.
Did you guys see the John Wick trilogy?
I cannot wait yeah. to see the third one. I haven't seen
it. I've seen it.
Oh,
I've
you
haven't
seen it.
It's
wait.
Incredible.
Yeah. Isn't he amazing?
It's really so good. Yeah, but that's, and that just goes, it's a testament to kind of what he's able to do. We talked about it yesterday with him. Is he's just such a likable guy. And the thing is, he'll try. I mean, we just saw him in Always Be My Maybe.
Yeah. Oh, fantastic. Another,
and he's in like 7 minutes, but so he just steals the show. So there's things that he just does very well. But look, this is exciting to, because I was supposed to see it last night and get a chance, but I heard that the premiere was just there was like a carnival.
It was
out of control. Yeah.
It was a huge party. Disney threw it on Hollywood Boulevard, a carnival, rides, yeah. games.
How did the reception seem to be from people walking out of the screening?
The applause started before the movie ended, which is
nice.
Yeah,
really, it was really warm.
Very nice.
You guys feeling more confident today?
A little bit. Yeah. you're always nervous going into it, but it was nice because it was a lot of people that hadn't seen anything, and
yeah,
you know.
Hanks was sitting right in front of me, and I knew he hadn't seen it yet, and he turned around before it started. He said, "Do you have a pen? Because if I have any notes, I want to jot them down and give them to you," as a joke.
Oh, yeah.
Total joke.
A little late.
Yeah, that's the point.
Yeah. He was. He's seeing him involved too. I mean, that's you want to get him. You want to obviously get Tim. Yeah. They're on board and hearing that. Is Randy Newman coming back to sing something else in this one?
Randy Newman did the score.
Yes.
Wrote two songs.
Okay, good.
He's amazing.
And how is the music?
The music is incredible.
I think it could
it
be
makes
his best work. It's incredible.
It really,
really?
Is.
Wow.
Yeah.
Does he do both the score and the soundtrack, or is he?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. And I think I'm glad you brought that up because I feel like his music, and is just as important as Tom and Tim. The way you just put that in that order,
it's
it just
staple.
Feels right.
Yeah, he's a staple.
I mean, you walk down Main Street in Disneyland, you hear his music playing, you're like, oh, that's Toy Story.
Yep.
You know, so it's and he killed it this time.
Well, it's funny because my daughter's 7 now, but three or four years ago, I would just have the Disney Pandora station playing, right? And so that song would come up, and she would just go, Toy Story, and she hadn't seen it yet because she knew that it was coming. Because I would tell her, I'd be like, you know, that's from this movie, Toy Story. And then the second we did watch it for the first time, it pops up. She knew it, and it's just it because. When a song, I'm a big proponent for score. Like score to me is as important as anything else too. I think it's underrated from a lot of people. But Randy Newman's music becomes a character inside of it. So I'm very excited to hear that you said this is his best stuff.
It's brilliant.
Awesome.
It's in that day the recording. We record on the Fox lot too. It was really cool. It was the Alfred Newman stage.
Yeah.
You know, so there's this heritage of his family and this business, and I think it was
we
back
did
to
Charlie
Chaplin,
Chaplin
films, yeah. And it was really emotional for us. And you know, we're doing. There's a scene in the movie where Jesse kind of has this little moment where she jumps down to have a little adventure, and this the strings, it, just that kind of cowgirl theme that you kind of remember, and hearing it live, I mean, it broke us down. I mean, it was just and it's effortlessly talented, this whole orchestra. Just seeing Randy run it was a real treat.
And the
for
last
us.
The last day, we really wanted to mark the moment, because it's like this is it. This is the end of another score with Randy for a Toy Story movie that's been going on for 25 years.
Yeah.
So we had a nice little tribute to him the last day. We kind of put together a montage that our editorial department made of kind of set to "You've Got a Friend in Me," and it was really really a special moment.
Yeah, what did he think?
It was really emotional.
Yeah. He's an emotional dude.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love him.
But you also his can't family. Get too schmaltzy with him, because you guys are
really funny guy.
Right. It's
really
funny. Yeah, no, I know. I was just yesterday, so one of my favorite songs, he sings from Major League, like the opening theme song about the Chattahoochee River and the bed going on fire. And he just did this whole, it was live, the one that I had, and he was just kind of talking to the crowd. He's a people person.
He's funny.
He's a funny dude. And he's like the John Williams of the Toy Story franchise. He really is, for sure.
I know this is kind of like Sophie's Choice, but I have to ask you guys, of 1, 2, and 3, do you have a favorite?
Mine's 1. I mean, I worked on 1. I was an intern on the first one.
Wow.
So it's a big part of my life, and it was the beginning of Pixar. And I mean, I love them all, but, you know, I default to that one. Just seeing them introduced, you know.
Yeah. Mine was 2. I worked on that. That was my first Toy Story film I worked on 20 years ago. But my new favorite, I think, is 4.
Wow.
It really is.
4 is our new favorite. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, man.
Can't say 4.
That's why I said 1, 2, 3. Yeah.
There's some, just the charm. It's almost like an origin story, number one. So I think that the charm of discovering the toys are alive and how they operate is so awesome. So I'd say 1 as well.
1. So last question for you guys before we get you out of here. You know, you mentioned before, as far as we know, that this is kind of the end of Woody's arc, and Marvel has done a thing with phases to where we saw some stuff happen in Endgame, to where some of the characters that we knew kind of going with them, we're not going to see their story anymore, but there's new characters that they built up throughout that franchise that we will be seeing. Could the Toy Story, not even necessarily call it Toy Story 5, but could some of the characters that we see, could we see them have their own movies? Could we see them continue on? And would you want to see that happen?
You want to tell them what we're doing?
I mean, we are doing some short films about Forky.
Oh, cool.
Right now, that are for Disney Plus. We've got 10 short films in the works starting. So in November, when that goes live, those will be out there. There's also another short film about Bo Peep that's kind of a spinoff that will be on Disney Plus.
Are they dropping all at once, or do you know how that's happening?
Yeah, they'll drop all at once right when it goes live. But in terms of features, you know, we really have been solely focused on that. We don't know what the future holds. Again, we thought it was over after 2 and after 3.
Right.
And we hope Pixar's a place that's going to outlive all of us. So never say never.
Awesome. Guys, thank you so much for joining us. The movie is Toy Story 4. It will be released June 21st. And once again, thank you to Josh Cooley, Jonas Rivera, and Mark Nielsen for joining us today in studio.
Pleasure
to have you guys. Congratulations. And go see the movie. I'll be seeing it. Can't wait. We'll be reviewing it next week.
Awesome.
So, can't wait.
Perfect.
All right, guys. Thank you. We'll be right back after the break.
Hey guys, Riley here, and let me tell you about Rule of Two. You looking for a Star Wars fix? Well, Rule of Two is that show. It drops on Collider Video's main YouTube channel, as well as on Podcast One's Jedi Council feed. So go over there, subscribe, share it with your friends. It's hosted by myself and Mark Fernandez. We talk everything in the Star Wars universe with a lot of deep dives and a lot of conversations that go all in. You know what to do. Subscribe, join us there, and rise.
Hey everyone, John Rocha here, the host of Collider Mailbag. A new episode drops every Saturday and Sunday in your face and in your ears, answering the questions from you fans about the world of entertainment, film, and television. Me and great guests from our sphere do the best to answer your questions from Twitter, from Instagram, and of course, email as well, every Saturday and Sunday.
Hi, I'm Koi Jandro, host of Collider Heroes, and I'm here to tell you we've got 20-minute episodes coming at you on Collider Video, on the YouTube, as you've always loved it. Plus, now we've got hour-long podcasts dropping every Thursday, so make sure to subscribe to the podcast, because it's going to get even more sweaty on the podcast. Plus, Every week, we're going to try to get some very special guest interviews, all of the people that help shape these movies and TV shows you love. So, video, podcast, interviews all coming at you. Be sure to subscribe. Thanks so much, guys. Stay sweaty.
Hey guys, Perry Nemiroff here to let you know that The Witching Hour is all over Collider right now. You can listen to that horror-filled podcast with myself, with Haley Fouch. We talk about witchiness, we talk about slashers, we talk about space horror, you name it, all on that show on the Collider Factory feed. We also have clips on the Collider Podcast YouTube channel, and on top of that, you can find an article all about Witching Hour every single Tuesday on Collider.com. Check it out. Get scared. Hopefully you survive the witching hour.
What's up, Collider fans? Ryan Satin here from ProWrestlingSheet.com, where you can find the top stories throughout the week in the world of professional wrestling. If you're a wrestling fan like myself, then you'd be doing yourself a disservice by not checking out all the shows we do every week on YouTube.com/C/WrestlingSheet. In particular, on Wednesdays, we've got a SmackDown recap show hosted by John Rocha and myself, where we pick apart and talk about every little thing that happened on the Blue Brand. So do yourself a favor and go subscribe at youtube.com/C/WrestlingSheet.
Hey guys, Perry here to let you know about the new edition of Collider Movie Talk. We are going to 5 days a week. We have a short, sweet, 20-minute show where we focus on the two biggest stories of the day. You can expect to see all of your favorite Collider personalities on the show, including Jeff Snyder, John Rocha, Haley Fouch. You're getting Josh Macuga every Friday. We're going to have a blast. It's going to be informative, fun. Come join us. 3 p.m. PT live every single day of the week right here on the Collider Video YouTube channel. You can also find the show on the Collider Movie Talk feed on our podcast network, so go watch, go listen, however you prefer to get all of your movie news.
Hey everyone, John Rocha here, the host of Collider Sports Time. Well, you know, if you've been watching us every week, you know we break down the latest and the greatest in the world of sports, talk about the big issues, the big games, all of it with a rotating band of guests like Matt Nose and Josh Macuga. We've had Taylor Bisciotti on. We've had so many great guests. Now, if you want to see more of Sports Time or you want to try it out for the first time, remember to subscribe to Collider Sports YouTube channel. And if you want to take us along with you in your ears, you can go and subscribe to the Collider Sports podcast feed for all the sports goodness.
Hey guys, it's Riley here. Let me tell you about the Riley Roundtable. You know it, right? It drops every Thursday on Collider Conversations, and I have guests from all across the space. John Rocha, Gray Drake, Alexander Desplat came on at one point. We talk everything from movies, we talk about life, and everything in between. What do you want to hear? What do you want to talk about? It's the Riley Roundtable every Thursday on Collider Conversations. You get it there.
Hello, how are you guys doing? I'm Kristian Harloff. I'm the host of Collider Jedi Council. We talk about everything Star Wars, and if you want to catch our weekly show where we talk about the latest and greatest in Star Wars, it's movie news, it's canon, it's all of it. We take questions from you guys. How do you do it? Main channel, that's right, right here. Subscribe to this channel, and you can listen, you can watch, you can do all of it. But if you want to just listen to it, you got the podcast feed too. Stitcher, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, whatever it is, you can listen to it in your car. Do all of it. It's Star Wars. Episode 9 is coming out, and then after Episode 9, you got TV shows, so we're going to be your sports center for Star Wars. Do it. Come on. Be real.
And beef and shoes and the beef and shoes, beef and shoes. Collider Live, ladies and gentlemen. It is Wednesday.
There was a DJ at Penn State that used to do all the Nintendo songs and DJ them.
That's awesome.
He's awesome.
I like those guys, man. I like those guys a lot. They were really, really nice. You could tell, like...
I think this movie's going to be great.
I think it's going to be great.
Do we know
good.
Anybody who was there last night?
No.
Why don't I know how this movie is?
Yeah. Well, I'm going tonight.
Is there an embargo up right now?
I think there is an embargo, for sure. But I think that... we're going to find out a lot tonight. There's a screening tonight. There's a screening next week. So we are, I mean, like I said, I think that there are, and I said it as much to the guys, and I think you were on that page first, and they were the same way, is that the three movies were done. They were perfect. And yeah. Everyone was like, but the way that they were talking about it, like they found it, they cracked the code of what mm-hmm. they wanted to do and the story they wanted to tell and the fact that they said they wanted to kind of tie up Woody's arc. In this fourth one, because they said it was Andrew Stanton that said, no, this is three was never supposed to be the end.
Yeah.
But I'm curious now if four is the end, because the way that they were talking, it could or it could not be.
I think it's the end for Woody. I think it's the end for the characters. That's kind of what I said, why I asked the question at the end.
About spinoffs.
Spinoffs and where they would go. I don't think it's the end of other toys that we have seen before, but I think it's the last we're going to see of Woody and Buzz.
I had to ask about Sporky, the doll. I love that talked question. About it so often so much on the show.
Because it's like...
Are you thinking about that?
They took a fork and put... You know, he said as much. It was a piece of trash that they turned into a toy, and then they were selling it. But if you look at the way that they're selling it, though,
too, it's a plush.
Yeah, but it's not just that. But it's even they're even the kind of detail. It's not like an actual piece of shit fork. Mm-hmm. It's like an actual toy. So it's
funny.
It's cute. Anyway, so I'm looking forward to seeing that movie.
Is there a premiere here in LA?
It was last night.
You think there's gonna be a line in there that says "fork you"?
In Soviet Russia, road forks you.
No, because
it was no. That joke was like the greatest joke of 1988.
That's true. Yeah. They told you who performed though last night at the Randy Newman opened, and closing out was Frankincense and Myrrh.
No way, dude!
They closed out. Yeah.
I tell you,
it was who?
Frankincense and Myrrh. Yeah. Okay, listen. You may think that Frankincense and Myrrh is okay, but when they came out with the hit Bricklayer Man. That was one of the greatest songs of 1987.
I got another one.
What do you got for me?
So Frankincense, if Riley's hurt, can turn in Frankincense and Merle.
True. Yeah.
Come on, Cody, hit me with it.
If Frank the editor went by the nickname Frankincense and he was good at movie trivia, Frankincense and Merle would be the greatest team really name in Schmodown history.
Don't give me the Odd Couple or Founding Fathers,
even Wildberries. Frankincense and Merle is just
Frankincense
fantastic.
And Merle is really good.
It's unfortunate that Dan Merle doesn't have like a party throwing vibe in his body because he could have a Christmas party every year called Frankincense and Merle.
Yeah.
And it would be a great name for a Christmas party.
I think Dan can party.
No, I think party. I just don't think I see him hosting a Christmas party.
Called Frankincense.
You know what though? Yeah. His girlfriend is a fierce baker.
Oh yeah,
yeah, she is.
Yeah, Mara's like an unreal
so
baker.
Good. Yeah, she is.
And so if they threw it together, she would make the bombest treats.
That's true.
I will say a treat at the party could be Frankincense and Mara.
That's good too. There's so much that we can do.
Can I?
You know what? Go.
Can I be honest?
Would you serve hot dogs, Frankfurters?
Can I be honest with you guys? So I know you don't like when I do this, but I just want to be included. I don't get it.
You don't get Frankincense and Myrrh?
What is?
It's Three Kings.
It's a Christian Christmas thing.
Frankincense.
So
Frankincense and Myrrh.
So when the Frankincense is basically a scent.
Yeah.
Frankincense.
Yeah. So when the three kings came to Jesus' birth in the manger, three wise men. What did I say? Three kings.
Yeah.
When the three wise men came to celebrate Jesus' birth, they brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Each three wise men had one of those.
Right.
Frankincense was basically like an incense, a spiced, scented aroma. I don't know what myrrh is, but it's
an essential oil.
It's an essential oil and gold, obviously.
No, it's an embalming oil.
Okay.
Cool. Well, good. So we wouldn't give that at the party.
Wow.
Thank you.
Thank you for explaining it to me, guys.
You're welcome.
All right, let's explain some more movie news. We have some other stuff that happened. So what's this the Dark Phoenix story? What is that?
Yeah, it's Ty Sheridan was doing an interview, and he basically revealed the original ending, and that it was going to be the Skrulls that they were going to fight, and it was going to take place in front of the UN building, and Dark Phoenix was going to come down, and it had shades of Civil War.
Yeah,
the end. And then Skrulls were involved.
So I think we knew this already because they went back for the reshoots, but it wasn't confirmed.
Confirmed, but the Skrulls is a new part of this because the Skrulls, as we know, show up in Captain Marvel.
Right.
So I don't know what the rights are with this because obviously they needed the rights to get them for
Maybe that was part of the reshoots.
Maybe it was all in the deals with Fox Disney. Who knows?
Yeah. It's just so interesting how many movies these days are doing the Skrull thing. Like, without giving too much away, 10 of the...
Of what movie?
What do you mean?
Giving away of too much... Of what? Oh, of Dark Phoenix? Oh, I thought you meant Captain Marvel.
No, you know what I mean, right?
Kind of, but I want to hear you finish.
You're taking on another person's face.
Yes.
Right.
That's like the villain gimmick. Thing. That's the gimmick these days in so many movies.
Yeah,
totally. Chernobyl, Big Little Lies, all of it.
Funny.
Thanks.
I didn't watch Billions.
How about Frankincense and Marvel?
Yeah, it was good. It was a good try.
Right.
It was a nice try.
At least I get it now.
You get it now. Okay, so yeah, you're right. That happens. But I think as far as the Skrulls go, it's better that it didn't happen. And it's also because to me it would just be like they were just kind of reaching, trying to figure out how do we make this work. It's just let it go. You know.
But don't you think that would have given Jessica Chastain's character more to
probably
do?
Probably, but at this point it's just. I don't know.
It's like, who is she and why is she there?
You know the thing with the movie, like I said about it, I don't think that it is a bad movie. I think that's it's kind of just a hollow movie.
I agreed. I didn't dislike it. I liked it fine.
No, I know. What I will say about the movie.
Yeah, I saw it Sunday.
I think it was an unnecessary movie. That's what I'll say. I mean, I understand why they did it because they want to close it out. They make some money off of it. They can do whatever they're going to do, but it wound up losing money. But
probably
but
the worst thing you can be is unnecessary.
It's unnecessary.
That sucks. Like, imagine that on your gravestone.
Yeah, it's just unnecessary. It is just an unnecessary movie. Plus, they didn't really try to even pay attention to continuity. Like, how is Michael Fassbender so young still?
Yeah,
I didn't care about that. He's amazing. He's the best part of every movie he's in.
But it's 1992.
I love that.
Eight
meme.
Years later, he's like 65 or 70 years old.
Yeah. No, he's great.
He turned into Ian McKellen.
No. Yeah. All the magnets keep him.
Does he become president or something?
Magnets. Yeah.
Because I mean, eight years you're quick.
Barack Obama aged.
Everybody. Did.
Yeah. It's a stressful job.
Oh my God. Never mind. You showed me a picture of somebody the other day that aged I know. Quite a bit.
I know, but I think he's sick.
Yeah.
That doesn't make it as fun.
No.
Okay.
All right. So, thank you so much.
Max.
What do you guys don't want it to say on your gravestone?
I don't want to talk about that.
Whoa.
Oh. Is that where we're going to go with this right now? Going dark, Phoenix.
Yeah. Oh! Yes!
Thank you. You like that one, Cody?
Yeah.
Cody likes
that one. Works.
Does that mean my new nickname's Phoenix?
Phoenix?
No.
No, it just worked for the bit.
Oh.
No.
No, right?
Nope.
Okay.
I miss Brian.
Me too. Rami Malek, by the way. Almost appeared in Rocket Man as Freddie Mercury, and studio considered a PG-3 rating after they shouldn't have done that.
PG-13,
but it makes sense that they would try to get Rami Malek because the same director for the most part, because Bryan Singer left and then.
Do you know whatever. I still haven't seen this movie?
Rami Malek almost appeared.
Look at that picture.
It's hysterical.
Oh, it's in the back. Yeah, zoom in.
Yeah, it's really good. It's like, hello, I'm here listening to piano music.
Oh, yeah, it looks like Hitler there.
Well, he's got the same mustache, but I wish that they would have done that. That would have been cool.
Yeah, I think it was cool. It's a good idea.
Why did they say no? They ultimately decided to stick
just
with,
wait until they're all in the David Bowie movie.
I want to see a Cher Universe musician movie.
Totally. That would be unreal.
I would love to see that.
I would love that.
It'd be so cool.
So maybe two,
Jamie Foxx shows up as Ray Charles.
Why don't we do it with a supergroup band? First, we do Fleetwood all of them individually, and then put them together as a supergroup.
Well,
like
happen.
Temple of the Dog. No. I'm saying pick an actual
group.
But first, we go and we do like
people
you know,
are hungry for that.
Soundgarden. I don't mind
we are the world.
From the mouth.
God, he was so. You know what? This is an underrated performance. But go
do
down,
you know that I haven't?
Down.
I haven't seen it. Really I can't like believe it. That.
He, look at him. I mean,
awesome.
Dude, he's so good in the movie, and it's like I hope because of when it came out that he doesn't get lost in consideration for when the Oscars.
Remember,
is it
come out this weekend? People, right?
No, it came out already.
A while ago.
Yeah.
A lot of people said that this was a really stupid move for him to take this role when he originally did. Do you guys remember that talk?
No, but you know, do you remember who was cast originally?
Yes, I do.
Oh yeah.
Oh no, I was going to say Sacha Baron Cohen, Jones. But that was Freddie Mercury. Who was it?
Tom Hardy.
Oh yeah.
Tom Hardy.
Oh, yeah,
and then Tom Hardy was he was out, but it makes so much sense now because the director also directed Taron Egerton in Eddie the Eagle.
Yep.
But
which is a very underrated movie.
And it was funny, it was because in Sing,
I'm still standing.
He crushed it. And that's probably he probably used that for an audition tape.
100%.
Sure he did. Why wouldn't he?
Yes. I totally forgot this was out. This is definitely on the list. I'm going to go see that this weekend. I think the wife and I'll go see it Sunday night for sure. Yeah. I mean, first of all.
Who do you think? Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Taron Egerton or
Ansel Elgort?
Lucas Hedges. Who's bigger right now?
Taron Egerton.
Lucas
Hedges is in a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
But as far as bigger goes, Taron Egerton is, I think, more well known.
Well known.
As far as, again, that not necessarily in our circles. Like
Ansel Elgort. Or Taron?
I would go Taron.
Still. Yeah. Yeah. Close,
baby, you guys have Maze a lot of runner. Faults in your stars.
Oh, burn.
Hey.
Thank you.
Speaking of good puns, I told you I went to that Yacht Rock band on Friday.
Yes.
Their guitarist was a guy by the name of David Bowie.
It's good.
Pretty good, right?
What's his name? Dylan?
McDermott.
No, you just said Maze Runner. Dylan.
McDermott.
No.
Dylan.
Ansel O'Brien.
Oh, no, I know.
O'Brien.
How's he doing? Is he better? That kid?
Yeah. What happened to him?
He got that big accident.
What happened?
Maze Runner. You remember Maze Runner?
The movie came out finally.
Well, no, Maze Runner.
I love those movies.
He was in he did one of his stunts and he got like, he was seriously injured. Yeah. Like, did they have that in the Wikipedia? Like, there it is. So O'Brien was in a harness on top of a moving vehicle when he was pulled off the vehicle unexpectedly and hit by another vehicle. His injuries, which included a
concussion,
facial fracture, and lacerations, were substantial but not life-threatening. In April 2016, it was revealed that his injuries were serious and worse than had been thought, and he would need more time to recover. After a few months of recovery, he eventually began filming on other projects. So he's recovered. Because he actually came in. I remember Perry interviewed him, and he came in probably a little bit after he started recovering.
Oh, man.
But, like, yeah, he's – I like that dude.
He voiced Bumblebee?
Yeah.
Yes, he did.
Interesting.
Yeah. That's right.
I like that dude, man. I think he's another one. I think he's a guy that needs to get some a little bit more work. He shouldn't be pigeonholed into that young adult stuff because he's pretty good
at it. But he also does look like the emo-ish, really good-looking dude in high school that girls are like, you know, I kind of like Dylan O'Brien. He's not like the jock, but
super cute.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm in.
American Assassin was a stink movie, but he was good in it.
Which one was American Assassin?
It was on the beach with his he was on the beach with his girl, and there's like a shooting on the beach. His girlfriend wants to kill. He kind of trains himself at first to just go kick people's asses. Mm-hmm. Then he gets trained in this program by Michael Keaton.
Got it.
And then it just gets foggy after that because it wasn't very good.
Do you guys think Adam Driver is an A-list celebrity?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
100%.
So I mean, I think Kylo Ren catapulted that pretty quick.
Yeah.
Cool.
Good talk, Roxy.
Good talk. All right, let's take some phone calls. We'll do the phone calls. You guys call in if there's anything you want to talk about as far as
who would you see playing David Bowie if we were like picking from people right now? And let's say we went to the Taron Egerton age.
My name is John Paul Jones.
John Paul Jones.
My friends call me John Paul Jones.
Can we call you?
Okay. So you can call
Johnny
me John
Flynn.
Jones.
Thank you.
John Paul Jones got eliminated yesterday.
Who's Johnny Flynn?
Good. Gone.
That's some trending. Yeah. Did she even go on any dates with
Johnny Flynn to play David Bowie in Stardust?
There you go. There's your answer. I would take Johnny Flynn.
Johnny Flynn is a porn star, isn't he?
No, I doubt it.
No, I mean, not that Johnny Flynn, but I think there's a Johnny Flynn porn star.
How do you know?
Because I watch porn.
Good.
I've seen it before.
Got him.
I've seen
porn. Johnny Flynn
tricked him into
player.
That one.
Okay, we got a phone call. Hey, you're on Collider Live. Who do we got?
Cool.
Hello.
Hello.
Jerry.
Next time.
My name is John Paul Jones.
Yeah.
Uncle Leo.
So do we get John Flynn is a musician.
Uncle Leo.
Yeah. John Flynn is a musician.
He was on Lovesick.
Scrotal Recall. Yeah.
What?
Love Sick was the one with
Gillian. Is Scrotal Recall the porn?
Gillian, what's her name? From Community, wasn't he?
Love Sick. I don't know what that is.
That's not the one I'm thinking of.
All right, Cody, let me know if we got somebody else calling in. Riley.
Derek. Oh.
No, I got somebody. Hey, you're on Collider Live. Who do we got?
Hey, what's happening, guys? You got Joey here from Dublin.
Joey.
Your voice is bomb.com.
What do you got for us today?
Cheers, thanks. Well, first of all, just to answer Macuga's question, Robert Sheaton from the Umbrella Academy, fantastic choice to play David Bowie.
He would be great.
Wait, is that's not the monster guy? It's like the emo-ish dude, right?
Yeah, the one.
He's good. He's really good.
Before I get to my piece, I just want to give a shout out to you guys for the job you do and everything you do, because sometimes things can be pretty hard, and it's a great release to check in with you guys and have some laughs and catch up on some news, so bring a bit of happiness to everybody's day. So a big shout out for that.
Thank you, friend.
Okay, so just something to run by you guys. So with this new Star Wars show coming out in Disney Plus, a couple of mates of mine in the bar recently had one of the guys brought up in conversation, would you guys be interested in seeing a pod racing Star Wars show?
Ooh.
You know, kind of looking at a mix like Days of Thunder crossed with Rounders and a bit of Goodfellas action with the Hutts involved.
Yeah, I want that show.
I mean, you know what it is, though? I think I'd like to see an element of it inside of the underworld. I don't know if I need let's say you made one of the main characters like a pod racer, you know, and a really good pod racer, and you spend a lot of time there the same way you would do, like in a show, like say This Is Us, to where you have But no, this is us. They have certain pockets of their careers, and you would go back and forth, and you would see like the brother who's the actor, yeah. right? You see his life and see what it is. You would flip to that You'd flip to that pod racer, and you'd spend a lot of time, and you'd learn about it to where you can, because then you can explore so much, and not just pod racing. You can explore a lot of pod racing and learn yeah. that. So I think I would like to see an element of it. I don't know if I need to see a full series of it, though.
I get where you're going with it, but I'd love to see that. I really would.
A full series.
I dig it.
I like his pitch, to be honest with you. I think that would be really cool. I mean, it would be secondary, maybe, the pod racing. That's and more about the characters. And I know what you're saying. But it all hinges on races and maybe every episode.
I like that. I just have the full. I mean, like, because even like Rush. You know, if Rush for Star Wars would be cool.
Yeah. Justin Hartley. Well, that's who
leave it up
about.
To a sweet dude from Ireland to bring up a racing gambling show. Yeah. I love it. Good work, bud.
My mate Tony had a great pitch. He kind of like looked at it from a point of view where you had this racer who was kind of beholden to the huts, kind of had to throw some races, and every Boxing's couple of down. Episodes moved to a new planet with a new racetrack with kind of different bits and pieces of shit that was going on.
That's cool.
And him kind of like trying to build his way through the ranks of the Outer Rim. And eventually challenge the core world champions and move to Coruscant. I thought it was a pretty interesting idea.
That is cool.
But his opinion on it.
Yeah, you know what I like about that also too, especially if you get it to Coruscant, is you can still this kind of just going off what I was just saying there too, is that you can. That's his in on how he gets to the planet, but it's our in on how we get to the planet as viewers. But we can also get to the politics side of things and other things that are happening, characters. You know, so that's was kind of my overall point, is that you can use it as a way in. So thanks for the call, man.
Joey,
I appreciate it.
Joey, yeah, good.
Great call.
Leave it to a lovely Irish.
It's a kangaroo's baby.
What are you talking about,
Joey?
Oh, it is.
We asked for that, I think.
I think we did.
I think we asked for it.
Yeah, you could have let it just sit.
Shout out to Joe Adonis Tack on Twitter, who said, you should Franken sleep in the hallway, Josh Macuga, with those puns.
That's a good one.
Yeah, I agree.
You should.
Porn watcher.
Sorry, Christian. You keep bringing up those puns, I'm going to frankincense and murder you.
Oh! Give it to him. Look what he did to his pen.
Riley's pen.
Nailed it.
Yeah. That pen's been on its way out.
Here's how low I was going in the puns. I was like, all right, the name of the guy in Sandlot was Mr. Myrtle. He owned the dog. Frankincense and Myrtle. It's the sequel to Sandlot.
I like that.
Anyway, let's do one more phone call, and we'll call it a day.
Not right now, Derek.
All right. What do you mean?
Riley, what do you got on Twitter, Facebook?
Facebook groups asking some good questions. I like this, because we had these great guests, and what's been your favorite guest on Collider Live thus far? Asked Brian Nussbaum.
Oh man, that's a tough one.
Dane Cook
yeah. for you.
But I don't know. There have been so many. I
mean, some really good ones. Yeah. Matthew Lillard was really good.
Lillard. I mean, Ralph Macchio. You guys will see tomorrow. He was great.
I thought Brecken and Seth were really
good. Together were fantastic.
Oh, I'm just being a moron. I'm blanking on his name right now.
Liam Cunningham.
No.
Ron Perlman.
Sir Davis.
Ron Perlman was awesome.
Yeah.
No. Alex puts Griffin Newman. He loves Griffin Newman.
No, yeah,
Alex,
no Griffin, this guy
was cool.
This guy's amazing. He's in the whole Seth Rogen crew.
Jay Baruchel.
Jay Baruchel. He was bomb.
Yeah. No, but Alex isn't wrong. Both Griffin and Peter were really fun, too.
Paige WWE was my favorite.
Paige was awesome. And then Vladimir Klitschko was cool.
Klitschko was good.
Klitschko was good for you, right?
That was a pretty funny moment.
Klitschko was good, too. I mean, yeah, we've had some good ones, man. John Noble. Jason Isaacs. Yeah. Really good. There's been some.
Benedict Wong
was cool,
was
too.
Dope
Yeah. Oh, I mean, Van Damme.
That was my least favorite guest. They got the best, like the best sound clips we've had.
I loved that Van Damme interview.
Want some cookies?
Yeah, I said yes.
My style.
What was the other one? There was one similar to where we said that it was like there was an interview recently that we just were like blown away by because we were like that was like how we thought like Van Damme was going to be.
Oh, I know who it was. It was from Cobra Kai. What's his name?
Oh, John Cove. Martin Kreese. Yeah. Martin Kreese was good.
Martin Cove.
John Kreese. I do that a lot. Yeah. Seth Meyers.
That was funny.
Hey, you're on Collider Live. Who do we got?
Hey, it's Ian from Toronto.
What's up, man? What do you got for us today?
Good luck to your Raptors friend.
I know. And just a commentary on the KD thing. I mean, there's a lot of execs in the lower bowl of the
of the arena, so, you know. It's probably a lot of execs. Like, outside in Jurassic Park, I doubt you have many fans, like, cheering on the injury.
That Jurassic Park looks crazy. It looks pretty cool.
Yeah, it's pretty wild. But anyways, my comment is on Ghostbusters, actually. Yeah. I was fortunate enough to watch live in concert on the weekend to celebrate 35 years.
Okay.
Elmer Bernstein's score is incredible. Sure is. And it just gave me a much deeper appreciation for actually scores and soundtracks in general, just being there and feeling, you know? But my question is, if you could have that experience with any score, have a screening, have the live score, what would you do?
That's a really good question.
I mean, it's kind of a lazy answer because I would go and see Hans Zimmer again when he's in town because he's got so many of my favorite. Like, and John Williams, I'm so glad I got to see him three times now. I've seen John Williams, and you want to see one of the greats for sure. But there's just something about Hans Zimmer.
Does he do Braveheart? Does Hans Zimmer?
No, was James. That was James Horner. Yeah, I know. I know.
Sorry about it.
But Hans Zimmer, if you ever have a chance to see him in concert, whether you are a hardcore score fan or not, go and see him. It's like a rock concert.
Yeah.
And it's like he puts on the show in general, but like to me, I would like to see the entire score for him play the entire score of Inception.
I was going to say too, even though I don't love the movie as much as the score is out of this world.
And John Bryan is another one that I like to see him do the full Eternal
Sunshine.
Yeah, and he also and what was it? Paranorman.
Paranorman
is an underrated score.
It's a great score. Really good.
Braveheart is me by far. Yeah. I mean, there's a cut above the rest. But I'd also like to see the soundtrack to Dazed and Confused played live.
Oh, yeah.
I don't care who the just cover all, band is, just all just those all awesome the, songs.
Yeah. Yeah. Both albums?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. For sure.
They have two volumes.
Yeah. If we get to do that, that's how I feel about like Garden State. Really cool stuff.
Garden State?
Yeah.
You know, Bonnie has a song on Garden State.
Does she really?
Yeah, Winding Road.
No.
Really?
That's her song, yeah. No she sings way. The song. You didn't know she sang Winding Road? Yeah, it was a very popular song.
Yeah.
Wow. That's such a good question.
Such a hipster soundtrack.
I'm going to go Alan Silvestri, Back to the Future.
That's a good one. I listened to the theme on the way here today.
Yeah. Oh.
What happened?
Forrest Gump.
Too. Also Alan Silvestri.
Yeah.
So good.
One last thing before we go is that, and I mentioned it briefly, I actually listened to the full interview from Batista with Ryan Satin.
Yeah.
You should definitely listen to it. It's really good. He talks about his movies, obviously, and being in Avengers and the fact that how much he owes to James Gunn because James Gunn took a shot on him. Nobody wanted him in the movie. Nobody was kind of taking him serious. And I really respected some of the things that he said to where he never wanted to be a direct-to-DVD guy because that's what a lot of the wrestlers are doing. He's like, I could have made a lot of money doing that. I didn't want to do that. I wanted to be taken seriously.
Yeah.
And James Gunn took that shot on him, and now he's starring in a comedy. It's coming up, too. And he talked a lot about...
Isn't that a weird name? What is it?
Stuber.
That's a Stuber name.
Well, because he steals an Uber. He hijacks an Uber or something. Yeah.
I'll be here all
year. It's also the driver's name is Stu, so he calls it a Stuber.
Right. Okay.
Yeah,
check out Pro Wrestling Sheet on audio, or believe it, you can just go to the actual website itself and check it out. Yeah. All right, guys, that's the show.
They call that me was little the head. Show.
So thank you to Roxy Striar and Mark Reilly and Josh Macuga.
Get your Smowdown tickets.
That's right. Get them for the July 20th show,
Rachel Cushing.
And thank you to our guests here today from Toy Story 4. Once again, Josh Cooley, Jonas Rivera, and Mark Nielsen for joining us in studio. Thank you guys for checking us out. Make sure that you subscribe to the Collider Live channel if you haven't done that already. Audio, definitely do that for audio. Download us anywhere you can find podcasts. We'll be there. So we'll see you tomorrow.
Holler.